Welcome to the first meeting in 2016 of the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. I'd like to wish everyone a happy new year. Could I please remind everyone to turn off any mobile phones, tablets or other electronic devices. Our first item of business today is to decide whether to consider our work programme in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Members have indicated their agreement. Our second item of business today is to take evidence on the recent UK spending review with Robert Chote, Chairman of the OBR. I'd like to welcome Mr. Chote to the meeting and invite him to make a short opening statement. Robert.
Good morning, convener. Thank you very much indeed for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to be back, as always. The last time I joined you to discuss the economic and fiscal outlook, I think perhaps fittingly, was April Fool's Day last year, following the coalition government's final budget. Obviously, since then, we've produced two further forecasts, the first alongside the post-election budget in July and the second alongside the spending review in November. I think to all intents and purposes, you can think of those as basically two halves of the same fiscal event. The Conservative government's used them to depart significantly from the provisional tax and spending plans that they'd agreed with the Liberal Democrats in coalition last March, setting out their own preferred strategy for the rest of the Parliament and beyond. So in talking about what's in the latest forecast, it's perhaps helpful to do a bit of the contrast with March, so you're pulling together the two elements of what the coalition has done to date. On that, I think the first point to make is that neither the underlying forecast for the economy nor the underlying forecast for the public finances has changed a great deal over that period, and almost all the action of interest has been in the policy decisions that have been taken and the makeup of the remainder of the post-crisis fiscal repair job. If you take the economy, back in March we were predicting that the economy was pretty close to full capacity, that it would grow by about 2 to 2.5% a year over the next 5 years, and that inflation would move relatively slowly back to its 2% target. And we made effectively the same predictions in November, and they're broadly in line with the average views of other forecasters. Now, those are our central forecasts. Obviously, history suggests that reality is going to be less smooth than that, but we think that the fluctuations are as likely to be above those numbers as below. Most of the key uncertainties around the economic forecast, I think, are pretty much the same as they were in March. When are we going to see a return to sustained, robust growth in productivity and wages? How is the economy going to rebalance in response to the continuation of fiscal consolidation? How will the UK respond to global events, tighter monetary policy in the US, slower growth in China, developments in Europe? Reflecting the recent stability of the economic forecast, the changes in the public finances forecast over the past year have also been relatively small compared to those that we've made in earlier years. Following the autumn statement, lots of people latched on to the famous £27 billion that we'd apparently found down the back of the sofa over the next 5 years. The biggest contributors to this aggregate improvement in the budget balance over the forecast period were a fall in the government's prospective debt interest payments, the knock-on effects of the recent strength of some tax receipts, and also some changes to the way in which we forecast VAT and national insurance contributions. These positive developments were partly offset by the impact of lower share prices on tax revenues, plus judgments that we made on the outlook for spending on disability benefits and property transactions. Now, unfortunately, £27 billion is not as much as it sounds. Over 5 years, it corresponds to an average downward revision to the budget deficit of about 0.25% of GDP. Now, that's pretty small beer in an economy where the public sector is spending 40% of GDP and raising about 36% of GDP in revenue, and where the average error in forecasting the budget deficit at an autumn statement, even over the remainder of the year that you're already in, is twice as big at 0.5% of GDP. Add in the changes to the forecast that we made in July, which went in the opposite direction, and we have an even smaller underlying net improvement in the budget deficit since March of closer to £10 billion, or cumulatively over the 5 years, or about 0.1% of GDP, again excluding the impact of policy measures. By way of comparison, if you look at the underlying changes we've made to our budget deficit forecasts between previous March budgets and autumn statements, we had a deterioration of about 1.5% of GDP in 2011, 1.25% in 2012, an improvement of 0.75% in 2013, and a deterioration of 0.25% in 2014. So I think the lesson from that experience is that what the SOFA gives, the SOFA can easily take away, and the sums lost or gained have often been much larger than they were last November. So, confronted by what are relatively modest changes to the underlying economic and fiscal forecast, what policy judgments has the Chancellor taken, taking the budget and the autumn statement together? I think the key point is that the key decision he's made has been to reshape the remainder of the fiscal consolidation, the fiscal repair job, to rely less on cuts in public services spending and more on tax increases and welfare cuts than the coalition's plans implied in March. The tax increases and the welfare cuts build up gradually and less quickly than the Chancellor said he was going to aim for ahead of the election. So he's also decided to borrow more over the next 3 years to help reduce the severest squeeze on public services spending in the middle years of the Parliament. He then aims for a slightly bigger surplus in the medium term. Combined with the changes to the underlying forecast, this leaves him on course to achieve his objective of getting the budget back into surplus in 2019-20 with about £10 billion to spare. The performance of past official forecasts, ours and the Treasury's, suggests that that corresponds to about a 55% chance of achieving a surplus in that year on current policy, so by no means a done deal. For public services, the two-stage loosening of the belt, as it were, in July and November means that the government's now looking for a real cut of around £10 billion a year by 2019-20, much smaller than the £42 billion a year by 2018-19 that had been penciled in by the coalition. That corresponds to a real cut in public services spending of about 1.1% a year over this parliament compared to 1.6% a year over the previous one. Smaller, but it's still quite a challenge. Obviously, a lot of low-hanging fruit has already been plucked, and the cuts are obviously much bigger than that average number in those areas of unprotected spending. On the welfare spending side, the government announced a significant package of welfare spending cuts or cuts in benefits and tax credits back in July, the proceeds of which the Chancellor banked when setting his welfare cap, the cap on the cash spending on a large subset of welfare spending. But by November, that cap had already been breached, thanks in part to slower than expected progress on disability benefit reform and also the Chancellor's decision to reverse the major tax credit cuts that he announced in July. That's costly in the near term, but less so in the longer term, because by then most of the people who would be affected are expected to have moved on to the new universal credit. The universal credit was also reduced significantly in July, but those cuts weren't reversed in November. So, wrapping up, if you look at the evolution of the forecast since the end of the coalition, the underlying economic and fiscal picture hasn't changed very much. We expect the economy to grow steadily, but at rates slower than you would expect after a typical economic recovery. We expect the budget to get back in modest surplus over the next 5 years, having now already more than halved from its post-war peak. But there are lots of uncertainties, as always, in the underlying forecast, not least the outlook for productivity and wage growth and what that means for tax revenues. And it's also important to bear in mind that our forecasts are based on current policy. They're an assessment of the most likely outcome under current policy, and a lot of other forecasters may think that policy might change. So some would look at the public services cuts and say, can these actually be delivered? Some would look at the welfare savings and say, can the government deliver the reforms logistically and the cuts politically? And some would say, well, if there are disappointments on either of those two fronts or on the underlying forecast, does that mean that they end up relying more on tax increases? Or does it mean they look again at their ambition to be running sort of sustained budget surpluses into the future? So there are lots of uncertainties, but fortunately those policy ones are outside our remit and for other people to worry about. So let me leave it there and very happy to take questions, obviously.
Okay, well, thank you very much. A fascinating introduction, as always, and also your executive summary on the economic and fiscal outlook also makes very interesting reading now. I know that a lot of colleagues have got questions they want to ask, so I'm not going to exploit my position in the chair, but they all smirk, but that's true. So I won't ask too many initial questions, Robert, but I'll certainly I want to touch on a number of areas which my colleagues will want to delve into in greater depth. And the first one I want to touch on is borrowing. I mean, you said in your introduction, you talked about the fall in debt interest and payments leading to some of the government's recent decision-making in terms of the money found, as you say, down the back of the sofa. But, you know, given the fact that, you know, compared to the July forecast, you've revised net borrowing down from 0.6 billion to still quite eye-watering £73.5 billion. I'm just wondering, in terms of paragraph 1.4, you've said spending on debt interest is also lower in all years, reflecting a further fall in market interest rates. But what would be the impact of a rise? Because, I mean, obviously, in America, there's been a rise in interest rates. And what is the likely impact on the finances if there should be even a modest rise in interest rates?
Well, I mean, you can see that the sorts of changes that you've had between the July forecast and the November forecast, I think on average interest rates or yields move by about 0.4 percentage points. And you've had, if you look on in aggregate over the 5 years, it contributes about 17 billion of the famous 27 billion. So I think it's an important, in July, those numbers have moved somewhat in the opposite direction. So it is, if you were looking at an uncertainty where, money can come in one forecast and go out in the another, that would be an obvious place to look. One thing it's worth bearing in mind is that we simply take the interest rates that are out there in market prices and apply them. We're not making our own subjective judgment of whether the market is over or under egging the level of interest rates. If you go back a few years, lots of people would say, well, they can't fall that much lower, and they have, and they have. To date, you've not seen a big movement in the opposite direction in response to the Fed's move, but obviously with the new year underway, people thinking about the outlook for the economy and obviously the expectations for the pace of future interest rate movements in the US and the links that would through, it's an obvious uncertainty, and it's one of those areas where relatively modest movements can make quite big differences to the fiscal numbers in both directions. But I think, if we were, we probably did have this conversation some while back and say, well, this has gone down. Can it go down much further? And of course it has.
Just to pursue that a little bit further, there would be an impact of, say, a quarter of a percent increase in interest or indeed a decrease?
We do have a ready reckoner in here somewhere. I can dig out the precise link. But I probably can't find it straight off. But as I say, if you look at it, we've had a change of about 0.4 has contributed the change you can see here in this report. So you can scale that down to 25/40ths of that.
Okay, fair enough. Now, in terms of GDP growth at 2.4%, you talk about higher population growth, and also it talks about an increase in mortality among older people, actually, which is the fact that higher net inward migration has driven some of that growth. How much of the actual growth in the economy is per capita, and how much is because I think that gives you a real underlying look at the strength of the economy, and how much is just the growth just by.
I can dig the number out. We would have that somewhere. The
increase in population itself,
Yes, I mean obviously you're affected here partly by whether you're looking at per capita by head of population or by the working population. The impact of net inward migration, for example, does increase overall GDP growth. You're increasing the population as well, but it also, net inward migration also increases per capita GDP growth because net inward migrants are more likely to be of working age than the native population on average. So things like that are not simply feeding through into headline GDP growth, but not into per capita.
Okay, now you say you continue to expect employment growth to slow as productivity growth picks up. Now, obviously, productivity is an issue which we have raised before, and it's been a concern, about how we actually boost productivity. What is the kind of changes in productivity that we're actually seeing at the moment?
Well, you're starting to see, we've seen some sorts of improvements, then we're going back here. We've had a set of GDP revisions since we published this forecast, so we haven't had a chance to incorporate that. You've had some downward revisions to GDP, which may have affected the overall productivity position. I think it's fair to say that you've seen some you know, some quarters of good news in comparison to what's come in the past. But in the forecast here, we took the judgment that it was too early to assume that the flowers were, that you can see, were representative of a much better outlook looking forward. So we continue to assume that you have productivity growth picking up back towards more historic levels, but that has been a prediction that we and others have made for some time, and it's taken longer for that to happen than anticipated. As you know, there's a long list of potential explanations for why productivity growth has been as weak as it has. One of those that people place a fair amount of emphasis on is the difficulties in the financial system getting in the way of the efficient allocation of capital away from relatively unproductive firms towards more productive ones. I think it would be fair to say, looking at the conditions in the financial system, you know, things are easier than they were, so therefore it would be a bit of a surprise and somewhat alarming if you weren't seeing some signs of good news in response to that. But I think certainly the view we took in this forecast was that it was, you know, we shouldn't yet assume that you've kicked straight back to a much more historically average performance, and therefore we're assuming a continued slower return. Now, that matters a good deal in the forecast, because obviously it's the improvement in productivity that you assume would underpin an improvement in wage growth, and you need a return to robust real wage growth in order to bring about the sorts of growth in income tax receipts that you're looking for.
Well, you just mentioned robust real wage growth, but in sections 1.3, 1.5, 1.23, you express concerns about the impact of the new apprenticeship levy, for example, on wage growth of about 0.7%. I mean, you say that by in 2019-20, at which point $8 billion increase in total departmental spend is largely offset by $7.2 billion net tax increase, mostly in new apprenticeship levy and larger rises in council tax. And you go on to say that the ongoing costs of auto enrolment and the introduction of apprenticeship levy will weigh on earnings growth. These are both economically equivalent to payroll taxes. So we assume that most of the costs will ultimately be borne by employees. You didn't really talk about that in your introduction, so I'm just wondering if you can give us a
The view that we've taken of the apprenticeship levy is to think of it as in effect a payroll tax, where, you know, most of the impact of that is going to be felt on wages at the end of the process. And so that is an adjustment. I would say, though, that there are obviously uncertainties around the impact of measures like that, of the minimum wage, which is obviously more on the employment side rather than on the wage side, the auto enrolment. But the underlying, is there going to be a return to historically average rates of productivity growth and the sorts of wage growth that is associated with that, is going to be much more important ultimately than the uncertainties around those. But we certainly have made an adjustment, and it's one of the reasons why we have a somewhat weaker picture for earnings growth and incomes tax towards the end of the forecast. It's one of the reasons, therefore, why the improvement in the underlying fiscal forecast between July and November is at its biggest in the middle of the Parliament, and then gets less of an improvement towards the end, because you have this weaker view of earnings growth further out. So hence the government having to rely rather more on tax increases towards the end of the forecast period in order to achieve what it wants to achieve on the bottom line of the budget deficit, because, you know, our forecast is not helping as much in 2020 as it does in 2018, and that judgment on the apprenticeship levy and earnings growth is part of that explanation.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, another issue which you didn't touch on in your introduction but is in your executive summary at 1.13 is the issue of asset sales. You say that it makes a difference between debt rising and falling as a share of GDP in 15-16, with $30 billion expected in the financial year as a whole and $24 billion realised to date. And you go on to say, when the government gives away some of the assets, as with Royal Mail shares and the planned retail offering of Lloyd shares early next year, the sale will raise less than the asset is worth and the public sector's net worth is reduced. Again, I'm just wondering if you can expand on that.
Yes, I mean, for some while during the last Parliament, we were forecasting that on existing policy, the government was not on course to achieve its old fiscal objective of getting the debt to GDP ratio falling in 2015 16. And for some while, the government had basically said, OK, we accept the forecast, but we don't think it would be sensible to further tighten policy in order to bring that about. What then happened is that the government announced a significant programme of asset sales in 2015-16, which are sufficient to bring the debt-to-GDP ratio down in that year. In subsequent years, the underlying primary budget balance, the budget balance excluding interest, has improved sufficiently that it gets the debt-to-GDP ratio falling of its own accord, and you don't need to rely on asset sales in the same way, but you do in 2015-16. So we wanted to be very clear with people that that was why this target had come back into play, having been out of play for some time. With asset sales, one of the issues that we always address in the forecast is, can we be sufficiently confident of what it is the government is intending to sell, when it's going to sell it, and what price it might get for it, for us to be confident enough of putting that in the forecast rather than merely citing it as a potential risk or a potential change. So in the scrutiny process that we've gone through, we've been very clear with the government about what level of certainty we need to have around particular sales for us to be willing to put them in. That said, there are some uncertainties. For example, student loan sales we now expect to be later than they were in the forecast that we produced in July. The final point on the impact on net worth, as I say, a key issue is if the government is selling something for roughly what it's worth, then the underlying health of the public finances is not improved as a result of that. You're simply getting money today instead of a flow of money in the future. There may also be instances where the government is deliberately selling something for is deliberately disposing of something for less than its value, and the obvious case there is if you're having a sale of shares and you give some of them to the employees, for example, which is means a diminution in net wealth, other things being equal, but the government obviously has other policy objectives for wanting to achieve that. So again, we feel that it's important when those sorts of things happen to highlight that, even though those sorts of changes in net worth and the full flow, the full implications of making an asset sale up front will have an implication in reducing your revenue maybe many years into the future, but it's worth highlighting that to people as one of the consequences of what the government's done.
Okay, thank you very much. I just want to ask you a couple of questions on devolved taxes, and then we'll open up to colleagues around the table. And the first one is on the land buildings transaction tax, obviously being one of the devolved taxes. And first, when one looks at the OBR's predictions of land buildings transaction tax, it looks as if there's going to be huge growth, from 15-16 to 2020-21, almost doubling in terms of your predicted revenue stream. But then when one actually looks at what the Scottish Government is predicting, you actually seem to be quite moderate. I know in terms of 2020-21, the difference appears to be the order of some £90 million in terms of what's predicted. And, of course, that includes non-residential and residential transactions. I'm just wondering, if you can talk us a wee bit through how you come to these kind of figures. Both Scottish and OBR predictions look to me to be very ambitious, even taking into account the predicted rise in house prices, etc., and an increased number of transactions over that period.
Sure. And the key reason, I think, for much more rapid growth, and this will be true of both our forecast and that of the Scottish Government, is that you have a combination both of house price increases and, in a sense, a continued recovery in the rate of transactions to something more like its long-term average. So the combination of the two of those is going to give you a much faster increase in revenues than you would see for example, income tax or VAT, so taxes on labour income or spending. I think the figures I have for 2020-21 suggest that, the comparison with the draft budget, so the more recent Scottish Government forecast rather than the one that we compare it to in here, is a difference of about £36 million by 2021. Our forecast for residential being about £70 million higher, the Scottish Government's forecast being about 70 million higher for residential and about 36 lower for non-residential. So overall, the Scottish Government being about 35 higher. On the residential front, I think that's three factors. The difference is explained by three factors. First, the Scottish Government is assuming slightly more rapid increases in house prices over this period, so about 28% in aggregate between 15-16 and 2021, whereas we have about 26%. On the transactions, the Scottish Government have a 15% increase in transactions between 2021 and 15-16. We have about 9%. So the Scottish Government's transactions forecast, as I understand it, and Commission colleagues will correct me if I'm wrong, is based on reaching a sort of long-run average of 6% rate of transactions compared to the size of the housing stock, and that's the average recorded between 95 and 2014. In our July and earlier forecasts, we were using a similar sort of approach, assuming UK transactions reverted to their rate from 91 to 2004 on average. But in this most recent forecast, we made a slight downward adjustment, drawing on research that suggested the fact that more of the housing stock is buy-to-let, and buy-to-let properties tend to be bought and sold less frequently than owner-occupied or other properties, and therefore we've adjusted that down. So I suspect that that may be part of the element. So I think most of the difference, and I don't regard it, you know, the uncertainty in particular around transactions means that I think that the difference between our forecast and the Scottish Government forecast is small in comparison to the uncertainty that lies around either of them. But you have, it's partly the Scottish Government taking a slightly more optimistic view of prices, a rather more optimistic view of transactions. The modelling approaches we use are also slightly different, and it may be that the Scottish Government uses a technique that we've been anxious about using in the UK context because we have more problem with the importance of very high-valued properties in London and elsewhere. And so I think that there may be a difference in the sort of implied number of relatively high-value properties in each of our two forecasts. But as I say, I would not regard the difference between the two as being large in comparison to the uncertainty that lies around either of the forecasts in isolation.
Okay, thank you for that very comprehensive response. And the reason there was so much scurrying about is we were just checking that the figures we were comparing apples with apples and rather than apples with oranges here. So everything
it's
seems
never
to be
entirely
okay.
Clear which year you're looking at, which can be.
Yes, in terms of the figures that I quoted earlier. Now, I did say I would ask a couple of questions, but I'm actually going to ask three, so just two more, honestly, folks. Be patient. In terms of block grant adjustment, actually, you know, the draft budget says, and I quote, until a permanent agreement is reached, the Scottish and UK governments have agreed a provisional 1-year block grant adjustment for the fully devolved taxes in 16-17 of £600 million. I mean, you know, there's no further information in the draft budget on the basis of this figure, how it's arrived at, but do you feel it's reasonable or perhaps slightly high, slightly low? What's your view on that?
I think you're taking me beyond my remit. These are deep and treacherous waters, convener, and okay. I think we simply provide the numbers and it's for others to put them through the political mill and reach policy conclusions for
right,
them.
Right, okay then. Fair enough, I won't press you on that then. But okay, then the last one I will ask at this point is really about landfill tax, because you know, there's you've significantly changed your forecast in terms of landfill tax from July last year and the current financial year from 94 to £140 million, and indeed over the next few years up to 2020-21. The figures you're predicting, forecasting, go down from 140 million, 120, and then back up to 140 million. But that's substantially different from the Scottish Government in proportionate terms. They predict that next year it will be 133 million, as opposed to your own of 131, but it will then go down steadily year on year, 123, 114, 104, 94 million. I'm just wondering why you're at such odds with the Scottish Government in that. First of all, why there's a dip and then an increase in predicted revenues, and why the divergence seems to grow year on year.
The uneven pattern is due to the interaction of what you assume about the volume of landfill and movements in inflation over this period. The reason for why our numbers are considerably higher than the Scottish Government's one is that the Scottish Government is basing its forecasts on the assumption that its landfill targets are achieved, whereas our forecast is based on current policy rather than current policy ambitions. And so if we had evidence that there were policies in place that would deliver that, then we would be inclined to incorporate those sorts of effects. So I mean, I note the Fiscal Commission's comment on this is that they were, quote, broadly satisfied that there are potential policies which could feasibly deliver the target which underpins the forecast. And I think the key thing there is potential. This is a methodological difference rather than a disagreement. We would incorporate the impact of policies that had been announced and that we were persuaded were going to deliver this, whereas the Commission, perfectly reasonably, or the Government, is taking the view that let's produce a forecast on the basis that we're going to achieve these objectives. And as the Commission say, they think there are policies out there that could do that, but those policies haven't yet been implemented. If they were implemented, then I would expect the numbers to get closer together.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. I'm now going to open out the session. The first colleague to ask questions will be Mark, to be followed by Gavin.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Chote. I just want to delve a little bit more into this, the £27 billion, which I was intrigued when you said it's not actually that big a number. I wouldn't say no to it, but I can see the point that you make. But I just wanted to test around the vulnerability of that figure. I mean, I think the Convener very... you know, quite rightly focused on the impact of interest, and if there was an interest rate change, and we have seen that movement in America, which obviously is going to set the hairs running globally. But in terms of the tax receipts element and also the VAT and national insurance forecasts, what's the vulnerability of those over the piece? I mean, what kind of how robust do you feel those are going to be over the period that the £27 billion is going to be realised?
Well, there are considerable uncertainties around most of them. I mean, looking in particular at what you might think of as the two modelling changes that we've made, one of them is in the VAT forecast, where we've had a problem that we've been underestimating the amount of VAT receipts by a particular route, in that there are deductions from VAT that are partly reflecting the fact that there are transactions which take place within government, which don't actually generate money at the end of the day for the Exchequer, because you're taking with one hand and giving back with the other. We had been assuming, or the forecast models for VAT, probably since before we were around, assume that VAT reductions essentially move in line with their historical trend. Now, the problem is that that works okay if you have public expenditure moving on a relatively straight line. However, if you have a period in which public expenditure is falling, then the amount of VAT deductions arising from VAT refunds is lower than you expect, and therefore you end up underestimating the receipts. So it's a long-standing and relatively untransparent model where we identified that that's effectively a mistake in the model. It would not have become apparent until you had a period in which there was a clear change in the direction of public expenditure. There is, and so we've corrected that. So that hopefully, you know, will produce a better forecast for the VAT refunds element. On national insurance contributions, that's an area where we've had an anxiety over the way this is modelled for some time. For historical reasons, it's been forecast using a model produced by the Government Actuaries Department, which is, you know, quite untransparent and quite hard to reconcile with what's going on with the income tax forecast. So you would get movements in earnings that weren't generating the sorts of changes in the next forecast that you might anticipate. So what we've effectively done is to say we're now going to forecast NICS on the same basis that we forecast income tax, so there's a comparable model. It's more transparent. We should be able to better check with what's going on in the income tax forecast is consistent with what's going on in the next forecast. That has the effect of making that change, boosts things, probably because we're taking more account of there's a more accurate picture of the amount of national insurance contributions being delivered above the or being paid above the upper earnings limit on relatively high earnings. So we think that's a bit better. So those are methodological changes addressing what we think would be sources of ongoing error in the rest of the forecast. There are, of course, uncertainties around them. There are obviously a lot of other things that are moving within the 27 billion or within the changes in the underlying deficit forecast. As you mentioned, and as the convener mentioned, you have debt interest, which the way we do the forecast will simply move in response to movements in those rates in the market. The largest element that was subtracting from this was actually the movement in equity prices between July and November. When equity prices are weaker than you anticipate, you lose money from things like capital gains tax and inheritance tax. So if you have changes in equity prices, and there again, we make a relatively simple assumption about share prices moving in line with the cash size of the economy, that's an obvious source of uncertainty as well. Another change is that the Bank of England has effectively suggested that it's going to start reversing quantitative easing a bit earlier than it otherwise would have done. That produces you some debt interest savings. And then there is a set of uncertainties around, you know, if you have particular sets of receipts coming in stronger or weaker, and most of the big taxes were coming in a bit stronger than anticipated in November relative to July, you have the decision about, is that new news or is that, you know, temporary good news that will go away again? How much do you push that through into the future years of the forecast? So, as I say, you only have to look at the size of the equivalent changes in between previous budgets and autumn statements to see that, as I say, what the sofa gives, the sofa can take away. And obviously it's for the Chancellor to decide, knowing that those uncertainties are there, how much room for manoeuvre he wishes to put into his policy plans in terms of achieving the objectives that he's set himself out, both in the formal targets and informally.
And I note in your report you suggest that the giveaways, as you've called them, amount to around 18.7 billion, which obviously is less than 27 billion, but is still a substantial amount of that. And given what you've outlined here, which what I'm hearing is that there are a number of uncertainties around the robustness of that 27 billion figure, in the sense that it strikes me that it wouldn't take a lot to happen for that figure to be diminished significantly, depending on changes that take place over that period. So that, I guess, would lead to some concerns that there may have been, even if there were a reduction, it could go beyond that cushion that appears to be there between the 18.7 billion and the 27 billion. I wanted to ask further around, you'd mentioned a number of areas where policy initiatives, delays in policy initiatives, particularly around welfare, had led to some money being available that wouldn't have otherwise been available had those initiatives been followed through. For example, the slow progress, I think you called it, on disability benefit reform. I guess there are some people who'd be quite glad that it hasn't progressed quite as quickly as it was projected to. But assuming then that the progress on that were to pick up, does that have a future impact in terms of the projections that are made, or is that factored in?
Let me pick up your first point to begin with. The one thing to bear in mind in terms of the comparison of the aggregate giveaway versus the aggregate improvement in the underlying forecast over this period is that under normal circumstances, you can think of an improvement or a deterioration in the forecast that kind of gets bigger over time, and maybe a giveaway or a takeaway in policy terms that gets bigger over time. So what's going on in year five is like what's going on in year two, only more so. This, both for this forecast and for the one in July, that's not the case. You've not got a sort of a deterioration or an improvement that gets larger over time. You've got an improvement in the underlying public finances forecast that's relatively small, but also focused in the middle years of the Parliament, and which therefore ebbs away towards the end. And equivalently, in the policy giveaway is front-loaded. So the government is, in a sense, giving away about £6 billion next year in additional public services spending and additional welfare spending by reversing the major tax credit cuts. But that giveaway, he's no longer doing a giveaway at the end of the forecast, because the public services cuts are spending increases are smaller. The welfare giveaway that you've had to begin with has ebbed away because most people are by then on universal credit. So the impact of the forecast changes and the policy is more substantive in the middle years of the Parliament than it is towards the end. So if you're thinking about how vulnerable are the Chancellor's objectives about where he wants to be at the end of the Parliament to all of this, it's slightly less than over the middle years, because there's more going on in the near term than there is towards the end.
I get that, but does that mean then essentially that if there is front loading of spend, if these vulnerabilities were to be realised, then it's a steeper cliff face essentially. If for example that £27 billion that you're expecting around the middle of the Parliament, if it were not realised for whatever reason, be it interest rates are moved up, be it the vulnerabilities around tax receipts and national insurance contributions that you've mentioned materialise, does that then make the cliff face a bit steeper because that spend has been front-loaded rather than spread across the piece?
Could certainly affect the profile of the borrowing. I mean, quite a lot, if you think about some of the uncertainties that, you know, if you had a change in market interest rates, if your movements in share prices, that's probably less likely to have the same lumpy profile in terms of adjusting forecasts and might have more effect at the end than it does in the middle. So you would, you know, it would change the profile of the way in which borrowing is moving over time. And you might find that, a positive or a negative surprise shows up proportionally more at the end of the forecast rather than in the middle than what's actually visible here from what's happened between July and November. And then obviously if there are movements in these things, it's for the government to decide whether and to what degree it wants to change policy to affect the profile of the deficit through the next 5 years, or whether it's really primarily focused on where it is in 2019-20 when it has a target to be in surplus or thereafter. So if you look at the overall policy changes that have been made between March and July, obviously the government has been willing to borrow more in the middle years of the Parliament, but it's aiming still for a slightly bigger surplus towards the end. So it's been willing to sort of, you know, to let the deficit take the strain in the middle, but is not going for a looser position towards the end. And those are judgments that it will have to make each time that you see the changes in the forecast.
Yeah, I think we will come to the point. The initial question, but the point I was making was that if that doesn't, if for whatever reason that sort of bump that was being expected as a result of that £27 billion uplift is in any way deflated, or I wouldn't suggest it would completely fail to materialise, but in any way deflated below the levels of input that the Chancellor is putting in, because you've mentioned these sort of front-loading and then tapering, that then leads to a position where potentially the Chancellor could be standing up mid-term and saying, I either have to borrow more or cut deeper in order to make up for a £27 billion that I was expecting, which is now not going to materialise.
Well, I think that, you know, if the improvements in the revenues in the middle period don't materialise to the degree that's anticipated in the forecast, then obviously he has a choice about, do I, in response to that, find some revenue from somewhere else through tax increases? Do I cut spending, which could be in public services or in welfare, or do I borrow more? He has shown himself between March and November willing to borrow more in the intervening years in order to, make the toughest of the squeeze on public services less tough at a time in which he hasn't raised sufficient money from tax increases and welfare cuts to do that on its own, so he could do that. As I say, whether he changed policy to affect the middle years of the forecast or whether he's focused primarily on the fact that he has a target for a particular to get a surplus in 2010 and a revealed preference for having something like a £10 billion surplus in that year. There are different choices, and you know he could respond to them in different ways. So there's nothing automatic about if you know there is a particular weakness in revenues in the middle of this Parliament, whether you have to respond in a particular way. You know, he's got his formal targets, but he also has the what he wants to see the rest of the profile of the deficit looking like. That's you know. There's many ways in which he could respond to that. There's no you know, definite requirement that if there's a weakness there, he has to go back and revisit the spending plans, for example. Those are you know, pretty much inked in now through the remainder of this Parliament. History suggests it's not impossible to go back and change those plans, but you know, this is not like a normal budget or an autumn statement in which you know there's another one coming around the corner and you can come back and tweak things again in the same way. This one has slightly longer term consequences because you are inking in spending plans for departments over that period. So you are, you know, the stakes are somewhat higher. But, you know, as I say, there are plenty of responses you could make on the spending side or on the receipt side if you did.
And then, obviously, the question that I had initially asked before I then sidetracked you was around the initial slow progress around some of the welfare reforms, and were those to pick up pace or to be implemented effectively over the next throughout the Parliament, and we'll leave aside the ideological differences that exist in relation to that. What impact, if any, does that have on the projections, or are they factored in?
Yes, essentially, the reason we've pushed up, one of the reasons we've pushed up the forecast for disability benefit spending is that a reform designed to move people, a money-saving reform designed to move people to a less expensive system, the reassessment of people from the initial system to the later system is not going as quickly as anticipated. There are also changes related to the, you know, the proportion of people you expect to succeed in receiving the new variant of the benefit. There may be changes in terms of the caseload, the number of people, you know, applying coming on. But if you have a money-saving reform that is going less quickly than anticipated, that's obviously an upward pressure on spending. If it ends up moving more quickly than anticipated and it saves the amount you expect per person moving from the old regime to the new regime, then that forecast, that deterioration, that forecast could move in the other direction. There's a separate set of forecast changes around the fact that the rollout of universal credit, the new benefit to which people will be moving over the longer term, has tended to be pushed further out into the future. That through most of the forecast changes we've done, that doesn't actually cost the government money. It saves the government money because in the original plan, a universal credit was going to be a more expensive, more generous system than the one it was replacing, although the difference between the two was as narrowed as changes to the future generosity of universal credit have been made. But I think we are struck partly because this is following the same pattern that we saw with the changes to incapacity benefit, that these reforms, you know, recent history suggests do not move as quickly and don't save as much money as fast as the government initially hopes. And our forecasts have reflected that, and we've ended up pushing up our forecasts on spending there. Each time we look at it, we try to, you know, not get ahead of that, but get the right way and respond to that adequately, but there does remain an uncertainty which we flag there.
And just finally, just following on from the convener's questions around LBTT forecasting, obviously you've undertaken a significant downward revision of your initial forecasts, and I think that's been done in a kind of staged way. I think you've downgraded the forecast on more than one occasion in terms of what you anticipated would come in. Forecasts now seem to be more in line with what Scottish Government are predicting, but you seem to indicate that you're not pursuing the same methodology as the Scottish Government in order to achieve that forecast. So I wondered what the explanation was then for your forecasts at the initial stage being much more optimistic, if you will, in terms of what would come in, to now moving to being more in line with what Scottish Government are predicting if you're not following the same methodology.
Well, I think that the changes, the reason for the reduction in this forecast is primarily about the story about the UK as a whole rather than Scotland relative to the rest of the UK. And it comes back in part to the judgments that we've made about assuming that transactions, you know, do not grow as much over the 5 years as we had originally anticipated, because we've taken on this evidence that a higher proportion of buy-to-let properties, there is a higher proportion of buy-to-let properties, and those are likely to turn over less frequently than they did previously. And we assume that that applies in both cases. I think in terms of the difference between the residential LBTT forecast at the moment, it's primarily the sort of, you know, the Scottish government has a stronger forecast for transactions, a slightly stronger forecast for prices. I suspect that the methodological difference, you know, I think it goes in the same direction, but I doubt it. I don't think it is by any means statistically significant. As I say, it's not a disagreement. We don't think that the Scottish government methodology is wrong. They use a process based on what's called a log normal distribution, which academic colleagues will be able to explain in much greater detail and correctness than I can. Fitting a distribution and then moving that, whereas we use a micro simulation, a more detailed picture of the distribution of house prices, and move that forward. The difficulty of using the Scottish government methodology in the UK context is that it you don't put enough weight on what's going on with relatively high-value properties. And for the UK as a whole, obviously, what's going on with very high-value properties, and properties in particular in London, is much more important to the forecast. So we've seen weakness in stamp duty receipts reflecting a fall in the number of properties sold at 2 million plus. You know, there aren't many of them, but they account for quite a large chunk of stamp duty receipts. So I wouldn't place too much emphasis on differences in methodology as a source of major differences in the forecast. I think, as I say, the difference between the two now, and I think probably beforehand, is just not significant relative to the uncertainty around either of the forecasts, and the primary source of uncertainty around those is what goes on with transactions in aggregate.
Just because obviously when it comes to the discussions around block grant adjustment, the UK government will use as its basis for those discussions the forecasts that you've made generally, and therefore that's why I wondered about whether there had been a change in order to perhaps enable, because obviously we had a big discussion that took place around the block grant adjustment in the initial stages of LBTT coming into effect. And I guess anything that could prevent such wide disparity in future would be welcomed.
Yeah, well, I think it's... I mean, we have a very good relationship with the Fiscal Commission. We have regular discussions with the Scottish Government and the Fiscal Commissioner, obviously, not in the room. They are electronically in the room when we're having the meetings at which we discuss with Revenue and Customs our pre-measures forecast in each round. And so we obviously ask whether there is particular information or, you know, interpretations of recent outturn data that we should take on board. What I certainly can confirm to you is that we would certainly not make any decisions on methodology based on what consequences that might have for a discussion about the block grant. We're producing the best forecast we can on our professional judgment, and it is for the UK and Scottish governments to use or misuse those as they see fit.
Or by Jackie.
Good morning, Mr. Chote.
Good morning.
Obviously, you economic and fiscal outlook at the tail end of November. I mean, has anything significant happened since then that would give you a different result if you were writing that same report today?
Well, we haven't gone through it, so it's hard to give a firm answer to that. We have had some GDP revisions looking, you know, at what's happened to GDP growth in the past, which the Office for National Statistics have shown a slower growth picture. You know, that's obviously something we'll have to take into account. It's not something that typically makes a big difference to our assessment of how much spare capacity there is in the economy, because we assume it's, you know, a revision both to the potential of the economy and to its actual level of activity. I think if you're thinking about you know, the key things that could move by the time we get to the next forecast in March, always the most important between the autumn statement and the budget, is what you get in self-assessment, income tax, and some other receipts in January and February. I mean, some people, I think, were surprised that we did not revise up our forecast for the deficit this year by more. We actually reduced it slightly, leaving aside the issue of the new treatment of housing associations. We think there are good reasons to expect the deficit to look better in, you know, the first quarter of the next calendar year relative to the same quarter a year ago than we have done over the previous three quarters. And there are a number of reasons for that, one of which is that there are past policy changes which should boost self-employment, self-assessment income, and that will show up in January and February. There are changes to the change in the UK stamp duty regime was implemented in December and therefore has a different impact in the post-December and the pre-December period. There's also the UK government announced some in-year public expenditure cuts back in June, which haven't shown up in the numbers yet. So if they're delivered, you would expect that to improve the numbers coming forward. And there are also a relatively small volume of tax receipts that the Office for National Statistics has said it's going to include in the official measures of receipts, but hasn't yet done so. But we've included them in the forecast because we're trying to forecast the numbers as the ONS will eventually define them. And so that again would change. So for all of those reasons, we think that there could be, or there should be, a bigger improvement in the budget deficit fourth quarter of the fiscal year on fourth quarter relative to the previous three. But there are big uncertainties, and I would cite, you know, always the uncertainty around what's going to come in terms of self-assessment as a key one for the January-February period. And it's further complicated by the fact that we have policy changes that are affecting that, as well as things like, you know, what's happened with financial sector bonuses, which can be an impact as well.
Okay, thank you. I want to move on to the devolved taxes forecast. I mean, you've obviously had a couple of questions on that already. My first question is around income tax, and I want to just look at page 11 of your document. Now, you obviously project fairly steady increases to income tax, and I suppose that's linked to growth in the economy and wages and so on. You then make the point, though, that the Scottish share of income tax is on a downward trend, and specifically you look at table 2.3 on page 11. You can look at what's happened between 12-13 and 20-21. Now, from sort of 13-14 up to 2021, it goes from 2.91% to 2.87%, so a fairly kind of sort of consistent drop. But from 12-13 to 13-14, there's quite a big jump in a single year, which is, you know, seven times bigger than any of the other drops. Are you able to just, do you know what happened between 12-13 and 13-14 that made that quite a big jump in a single year? Because if you had that every year, obviously it would be extremely alarming. But what happened that year, do we know?
Well, I think the data for 12-13 only became available in January 15. So that was, you know, because it's based on the survey of personal income, it comes in with a considerable lag. That lag, fortunately, will go once we have people flagged as Scottish or non-Scottish taxpayers. And the main reason why you see changes in the share is that you've had a series of policy changes that are, in effect, giveaways at the relatively low incomes, particularly the increases in the personal allowance. And there have been measures, on the other hand, which increase income tax at the top. And because of the differences in the income distribution between the Scotland and the rest of the UK, if you have policy measures that are a giveaway at the bottom and a takeaway at the top, that is likely to shift the Scottish share down, because, you know, there are fewer people paying the increases and more people benefiting from the reduction. So I presume the 12-13 to 13-14 is because of the concentration of those sorts of measures that were taking place in that year, although I can't remember precisely which ones took effect in that year.
Okay. And you would then get the official data for 13-14 roundabout now then, is that right? Or this month at some point?
Yeah, certainly I think between now and the time we do the next forecast, so the next forecast we'll have another year of SPI data and another estimate of the share. Now, it's important to bear in mind, because it's a survey, there is going to be uncertainty about whether that has captured it. So the movement in the share between any 2 years might be affected by the fact that the survey is giving you a slightly high measure in year one, a slightly lower measure in year two. So there will be some additional volatility, which hopefully will come out once we no longer have to rely on the SPI to give us shares, but instead we can rely on HMRC flagging people.
Okay, no, that's helpful. Thank you. If I move on to LBTT, and in particular page 20 then of your document. Now, the convener has asked you, I think, already about some of the disparities between your projections and the Scottish Government projections, and you've given a number of answers there. Higher house prices slightly higher house prices over time, quite a big difference in transaction forecasts over time, and different treatment of a buy-to-let, to explain some of it. And so that, I guess, probably explains what happens over the course of the forecast period. But if we look just specifically at next year, i.e. 16-17, table 3.3, you're saying for next financial year residential LBTT will be £253 million, whereas the Scottish Government for residential LBTT for the next financial year are saying it will be £295 million. So while I would see by the end of the forecast period these factors would come into play and that would explain the disparity, I just wonder, is there an obvious explanation why there is a difference of, you know, £42 million just for next financial year for residential LBTT?
It may reflect the most recent outturn data that each of us had available at the time we were doing the forecast, and how much of that you push through into future years, as it were, the baseline, so that you could have a baseline difference, and then the size of the difference differs if you have the variance moving in different directions. That's one possibility. I don't know whether at that stage you still have the differences we have in the amount of assumed forestalling is having an impact by that year, where that's obviously mostly showing up as a 15-16 story. I think we have a higher number for stalling than the Scottish Government do for residential, and we also, I think, have one that the Scottish Government doesn't for non-residential. So I'm not sure that may be affecting the year-on-year comparison as well, but it might well be the fact that we're working off different starting data of what's coming in through the year and pushing that through the rest of the forecast.
Okay, thank you. So you gave explanations about the differences over time for residential. In terms of non-residential transaction, I guess that the position is reversed in a way, in that the Scottish Government are less optimistic than you are for next year, but over time. So if we take non-residential LBTT, you're saying, or your projection is £243 million next year. The Scottish Government projection is £220 million for next year. And over each of the next 5 years, you're predicting more than they are for commercial or non-residential. Are you able to explain the difference in those figures? Is there a different approach taken by each of you?
There is a somewhat different approach, again, on the methodology. The Scottish Government, I think, uses our determinants to drive their forecast, but the starting point is a three-year average of the outturns rather than the latest year. Because we're using a micro-simulation model, we use a single base year of 2013-14 and then say, how is that going to look if you push it forward into the future? So how much of it is that is a difference. How much exactly of the difference between the two is explained by that, I'm not entirely clear. Obviously, Fiscal Commission colleagues may have a view on that as well.
Okay, but just so I'm clear on that one, so you're using a single base year and they're using a three-year average.
That's right. Okay. So I mean, there's, you know, and that's always with these sorts of things, a choice you have to make about, you know, do you want something that's more stable or do you want something that's more timely? And there's no right answer to that. But the, given the techniques and the use of a micro simulation approach, then we have to. You know, it's more likely we lean in that direction.
Okay. No, thank you. Questions on landfill have been dealt with already. Can I go back to your executive summary then of your general economic outlook? So moving away from the devolved taxes paper. Again, a number of questions have been dealt with that already. Can I look at page 12 of your executive summary? Just a couple of things, a couple of questions in that table. So table 1.1, which is sort of most of the page. In terms of expenditure components of GDP, the third one of those is business investment. And so if we take 2014 as the starting point, 4.6% goes up to 6.1, 7.4. So you're seeing fairly consistent and healthy growth of business investment. When you get to 2020, though, it's a pretty sharp fall back down to 4.5%, which is a smaller percentage growth than we saw in 2014. What is happening in 2020 to business investment?
I suspect that that's a consequence of the changes in the expenditure plans, the public expenditure plans, which in the last year there was sort of quite the government sort of introduced a sharp increase in public sector capital investment, but they've had less of an increase in the overall public services spending. So I think it may be the fact that we're effectively, you start with a path for GDP as a whole. If you have movements in, you know, the composition of the fiscal giveaway and takeaway in that sort of year, we'd assume that because it's right at the end of the forecast, it's something that will come out in the wash in terms of its overall impact on the economy, on the growth rate of the whole economy, because the Bank of England will take that into account in setting interest rates in a way in which it wouldn't take into account changes that happened, you know, very near term, but that it would change the composition. So, you know, if you're having more going on in the public sector at that level than you had in the previous forecast, to get everything to add up, you're making movements in the other elements of it. So I suspect it's probably it's a consequence rather than a particular view that there is something that businesses need to be terribly worried about as we move into 2019 spring.
All right. Okay, thank you. Helpful. And last question, just on that same table, just slightly further down, inflation, CPI. The figures you put there, I mean, are they Bank of England projections or are they your projections for CPI?
No, there are projections for CPI. I mean, we still, in effect, assume that the Bank of England is aiming to achieve the inflation target that it's been given of 2% at the end. We have inflation returning to target slightly more quickly than we did back in July. That's partly because of greater assumed pressure from unit labour costs pushing those up. I think the Bank of England, if memory serves me right, has inflation returning to target, you know, somewhat more quickly still than we do. But if you look at the differences, you know, we're talking about tenths of a percentage point below the inflation target. So, again, I wouldn't overstate the significance of any differences there. But they are our numbers, not, you know, we take the market's assumption of what is going to happen to interest rates, but we do our own forecast for inflation.
Thank you, sir. Camino, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Jackie?
As ever, most of the questions have been asked, but nevertheless, seeing as you're here, we'll go through some of the detail. I'm absolutely clear about what you're saying about the Scottish share in tax revenues declining as being fewer tax, higher rate taxpayers, changes made in terms of policy decisions. But is there anything else that's underlying that? Because I'm conscious that, you know, employment rates are different, unemployment rates are different. There's population decline here, where it's projected to increase across the UK. So I'm wondering how those other factors might potentially come into play.
I don't think that we're assuming, you're right that there are those sorts of differences between employment rates and unemployment rates. What would matter in terms of the share is whether those differences, the size of those differences changed over time very much. If there's a relatively stable relationship between those things, even if they're different, that's not going to have the share moving around a great deal. So I don't think it's an important driver of what's going on with the share and the forecast. We're not making any implicit or explicit assumptions that the relative performance of the Scottish labour market versus the rest of the UK labour market is materially different.
Okay. What about GDP, Scottish GDP relative to UK GDP levels? What are your predictions for there, or do you not do that at all?
Well, again, there we don't produce we disaggregate our forecasts for the economy by different types of spending, by different types of income, but we don't disaggregate it geographically or by different industrial sectors. There are other forecasters who do that, but it's complicated enough doing it the way that we have to do it. And obviously one of the issues which has come up before, obviously, in discussions of the Commission's job and our job and how one should base the Scottish, is that the availability and timeliness of the data to do a full-blown Scottish macroeconomic forecast, it's more difficult than it is for the UK as a whole. The task of doing one that is simultaneously consistent with a UK forecast is greater still. So we haven't made an explicit or implicit judgment about sort of the relative performance of Scottish and rest of UK GDP over the forecast.
Might be something that is of interest as we move forward, but there you go. I noticed, just as it might be a side issue in your report, you talk about the reclassification of housing associations. You may be aware that we've had discussions in Scotland with Eurostat and ONS about classification of private or public sector capital projects. Is this something that's on your radar, or is this something that is more properly considered by the Scottish Government? Because it will have an impact.
It's not something I'm aware of, but it's certainly, if you think we should be aware of that, and or my colleagues may well be aware of it, then very happy to look at that. As you say, on the housing association stuff, I mean, it does underline the fact that what Eurostat says is appropriate matters as well as what the domestic authorities do, and often these sorts of changes are a reflection of the interpretation and implementation of rules that come up at the European level. I mean, the reclassification of housing associations was something that we'd warned might happen back in July, given the fact that the decision is taken on the basis of where effective control is exercised rather than ownership, and because the government was effectively telling housing associations what rents to set and other things, that might be something that the ONS would look at, and indeed they have done. The government has, of course, said that it wants to undertake a liberalisation which would move it back in the other direction. We have not assumed that in our forecast. If the ONS indicates that the government has done enough to make that a likely outcome, we'll address that. But for the time being, we're assuming that housing associations stay in the public sector for the duration of the forecast.
Could you give us a kind of order of magnitude of what impact that has on the budget, on public sector borrowing? Because we're grappling with the same issues here, and obviously classification is at the heart of this, and discussions continue with ONS. But it's what the consequences of having it reclassified as a public sector project that I don't think is fully understood.
Well, on the housing association side, it's pushed up both net borrowing and net debt. net borrowing, I think, by about 4 billion or so, diminishing over time. The net debt change is about 60 billion pounds, about 4%, 3-4% of GDP. The business model, as it were, for housing associations is essentially, you know, they have grant income. They're trying to run an operating surplus on the properties that they're owning already. They have grant income. They then leverage the income by borrowing in order to do more house building. So one of the reasons why we've had, you know, the impact on the deficit declining over time is the decision to restrict the way the rent increases would mean less income for housing associations, would mean less ability for them to leverage and to borrow more, and that has less impact on the budget deficit. Though there have been complicated sets of, you know, in addition to the changes in what rents housing associations are able to charge. The government has restructured the grants to housing associations quite a lot in the autumn statement, so lower to begin with, higher towards the end of the forecast, more skewed towards shared ownership rather than standard social housing. And I think one of the uncertainties surrounding this new element of the forecast is that the government is, in a sense, kind of pushing housing associations towards a new, different business model from the one that they probably were sitting there thinking they were pursuing. And it remains to be seen how willing or able they are to be pushed in that direction, which will then feed back onto the size of those changes.
Okay. I think that's helpful for us. Although a different context, we face some of the similar discussions and issues moving forward. Can I move on to the devolved taxes? And I have to say that there was criticism of you being over-optimistic at the beginning of this process, and now I'm just curious that you are less optimistic than the Scottish Government. And I wonder what happened in between. Now, I hear what you say about assumptions made about prices.
Sort of pattern that you would expect to see over time. If one of us is more optimistic than the other continuously, then you probably have more concern.
I look forward to when you're both on the same page. That will be interesting. But according to you, the Scottish Government have made assumptions about prices and about the number of transactions that are greater than your model suggests. Would that be fair?
That's right. As I say, from the transactions, on the transactions difference is larger than the prices difference. As I say, the Scottish Government is basically taking an approach which we've taken for some time as well, of assuming that transactions get back to some historical average. Now, the difficulty that we've wrestled with this before this became an issue with LBTT being a separate tax, of the changes in housing tenure that you've seen over time. Such a big reduction in housing transactions relative to what you saw prior to the crisis. In those circumstances, a big challenge in producing a forecast is, what's the medium-term new normal to which you think you're going to be returning? And there's obviously a lot of uncertainty about that, and both we and the Scottish Government have to make judgments about that. As I say, I think one of the reasons why there's a difference at the moment may be that we've explicitly assumed that the normal level of transactions to which you return is lower than we had assumed in July, because we've taken on board this evidence that, if you have more buy-to-let properties, those will be bought and sold less frequently. But as I say, the uncertainty around, I think this is always going to be the challenge with this area. Reaching a judgment on quote-unquote who does the better forecasts is that the length of time you would need to distinguish between luck and judgment when so much is dependent upon on the level of transactions. In the UK context, an awful lot also depends on the relative movement of high value to low value properties. That would also be an issue in Scotland, but not to the same degree. There's less of a, less of the smaller proportion of the revenue is coming from relatively high down properties, but the transactions is probably the large one. But as I say, I wouldn't put a great deal of faith about anybody's firm forecast for transactions in any event.
I think the one thing that we have discovered is that you can't account for people's behaviour, and this is something I'm sure we'll pursue with the Fiscal Commission shortly. But to what extent does your model account for kind of behaviour? Because I think the degree of forestalling that we saw exceeded your estimates, and indeed I think probably exceeded the Scottish Government's, and it was only when data came forward that we were able to estimate that. To what extent do you try and model for people's behavioural responses to tax changes? Because that's something that I don't think we do in Scotland to any great degree yet.
Well, we always try to do that, because it's always, as you say, it can be very surprising how big the numbers. The classic case within the UK context is the movements in the higher rate of income tax from 40 to 50 to 45. If you pre-announce that, you're dealing with a part of the population that is able to manage its financial affairs in such a way that you can move income from year to year, and the sums of money that are moved over those periods are enormous, and make the task of working out what the underlying behaviour of income tax over those periods extremely difficult and still debated now. In terms of LBTT specifically, I think we've raised our assumption of the amount of, or estimate of the amount of forestalling from 20 to 30 million. I think, and again, Fiscal Commission colleagues will correct me if I'm wrong, the Scottish Government had a sort of range of 12 to 37, which they initially thought it would be towards the lower end of that. But I think the Commission's report on the draft budget, if I read it correctly, was pointing at something in the sort of low 30 area, but I may be misinterpreting them, so please check. We have also 10 million of forestalling effect in the non-residential forecast. I don't know whether the Scottish Government has one in there at all. There's a separate issue about whether you think that the move to LBTT and the higher rates at the top is going to have an impact on behaviour in the long term above and beyond what goes on with forestalling. There we do assume that higher average tax rates towards the top are going to lead to fewer transactions and also have an impact on prices as well. We incorporate those effects. We explain the numbers that we've used, but again, the uncertainty around them is significant.
Final question, convener, is the 30 million forestalling figure that you've arrived at the final figure, or is there likely to be further discussion?
I don't know, further discussion, there's certainly going to be more, there's going to be more data coming in over time. The one's best estimate of what this has done, it's a much larger and more difficult example with the income tax rates. As you come back and look at your forecast after a few years and then, the interpretation of what was going on in the underlying picture and therefore what the unexplained bit that is best explained by what was going on with forestalling can change well after the event. So I would be very surprised if this is the last word on that or the last number on that subject.
Great. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you to committee members for the questions. Just got a couple of further points, actually, before we wind up the session. In terms of paragraph 136, in your executive summaries, you say that taking account of expected underspending against the government's plans, we expect resource departmental expenditure limits spending to be cut by 10.4 billion in real terms by 2019-20. What's the kind of level of expected underspend?
It's a relatively small number. I mean, this is a reflection of the fact that departmental expenditure limits, the clue is in the name, it is a limit that the government sets in aggregate on spending. And historically, even when public expenditure is rising quite rapidly, you have departments and the Treasury coming in below that number. So, the departments know the Treasury is standing there with a big stick. The Treasury is obviously keen on ensuring that these things are met, and they tend to come in. The underspends, we've had historically relatively large ones at the sort of 6 billion a year. Further out, the numbers are typically in the sort of 3 to 4 billion a year. I can probably again find you a precise number for what it is later on, but it's normally in the low single-digit billions.
We are allowed 0.6% of resource and 1.5% in capital in terms of the ability to be below that. But I was just wondering what the scale of it was, because you mentioned it specifically in terms of how you expect it to impact on the resource limits. And just one other point. To what extent your forecast... Sorry.
...is on the table, page 127, we have assumed the assumed underspending against the limits in each year of the forecast. So 2016-17, assumed underspend of 1 billion on current spending, 2 billion on capital. By 2020, 1.5 billion on current, 4 billion on capital.
Okay, 5.5 billion. Okay, well, thanks very much on that. Now, so just as I was going to continue, the accuracy of your forecast relative to Scottish Government's, I think we'll soon find out over time by looking back at what was forecast and what the outturn figures were. But I'm just wondering to what extent...
Before we have a firm answer to that question, all right.
Now, you've just been looking at your own morbid report here about how the number of older people are tending to pass away in greater numbers, according to your report. So don't be too pessimistic. You're not quite in that category yet. But just to what extent are your forecasts for the devolved taxes based on the available outturn data?
Well, each time you come to do the forecast, the outturn data that you have, the latest available, is an important input, and you typically look at, you know, how that's comparing with the forecast that you had for the year as a whole. What does that imply would need to happen over the remainder of the year for the original forecast to look sensible? So it's obviously helpful when that data is relatively timely and relatively frequent. So I think it's the case that for LBTT, it's sort of it's monthly numbers, whereas with landfill, it's less frequent and you've got, you know, less to go on. But it's always an important input, and I think it's one of the key judgments. It comes back to our job and the Commission's job in judging reasonableness is each time you come to do a forecast, there are broad questions of methodology, but then there's the question of how do you interpret what has happened in recent outturn data. If it's higher than you thought previously, is that good news that you expect to persist and you push into the remainder of the forecast, or do you essentially say this is noise and we'll assume that either it comes back down to the level we originally anticipated or maybe it'll undershoot next year to offset the overshoot this time? That's a key judgment about which reasonable and unreasonable people can always differ.
Fascinating stuff. Is there any further points you would like to raise with the committee before we wind up this session?
No, I think that's you've covered the territory admirably.
Okay, well, thank you very much, actually, for your contributions and your response to our questions again today, Robert. That being the end of this session, we'll call a recess and we'll restart the session at 11:05. Let's get this show back on the road. Our next piece of business today is to take evidence on draft budget 2016-17 from the Scottish Fiscal Commission. We are joined today by Lady Susan Rice and Professor Campbell Leith. Professor Andrew Hughes Hallett had hoped to join us from the USA by video conference, but unfortunately technical issues have meant that this is not possible, and Jim was unable to lend his private jet to get him over here in time for the committee. So I'd like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite Lady Rice to make an opening statement. Lady Rice.
Thank you very much, Convener. Thank you for having us back so soon after our last visit to the committee. And could I offer on behalf of the Commission good wishes to all of you for the new year. Can I also offer Andrew's apologies? He really had wanted to be with us, but I would assure you of two things. One is that yesterday we spent many hours, the three of us, on a phone call, so we're very current with his thoughts and his thinking, as we did in the run-up and the writing and the finalization of the report. If there are questions that we think really are in his area of expertise, we would let you know that he might be able to add something further that he can't do just at the moment. Since we last met on November 25th, the Commission has published its report on the draft budget 16-17, as you know. We concluded that the forecasts were reasonable, and we also made a number of recommendations in the report. We'd note in particular that the forecasts are now being done on a five-year basis, which is good. That makes them consistent with other forecasts in the UK. It also perhaps adds, in our eyes, some urgency to some enhancements to the forecasting methodologies that the Scottish Government uses, which would be more suitable for that five-year time frame. You will have seen that our report itself has evolved. It's longer, it's fuller in explanation and background. It contains appendices not just of our activities over the year, but minutes of our challenge meetings with the Scottish Government. We started producing these minutes, as you know, in August when we had a resource to do so. And I would state that the minutes are, as minutes of meetings should be, agreed by all participants there. So the report has evolved. It even has a cover and paragraph numbers, I say that tongue-in-cheek, but we expect it to continue to evolve over time. Our way of working has also evolved, and we hope that that's apparent to some extent in the report. I want to say that we have valued our engagements with the Finance Committee, and we've taken steps such as producing these minutes to provide evidence, we hope, of transparency and of independence, two themes which have come up in our discussions with you over last year. We also want to note that the Finance Committee has published its report on the draft bill, and that will clearly lead to further evolution of the Commission over time and once the bill is actually finalized. In the report, we've made some promises for the future. We've promised to develop in the coming year a protocol on how we go about working, on how we interact with the Scottish Government, and we've begun some early thinking on that. We state that we will do our own analysis of the outturn numbers once we have a full year's worth of outturn numbers for the devolved taxes. That's really important. We know the Scottish Government will do that as well, and clearly we will need to see where that takes us. And we also state that we will begin a program of producing some technical papers, and we are just starting to think about what they might comprise. We don't have any in the hopper at the moment, so please don't look for them in a week or two, but they will come. To conclude, I would say that our key concerns out of this year's assessment and scrutiny of the Scottish Government forecasts are, and I'll just state them very succinctly, for LBTT, we were pleased that the Scottish Government, as it looked at the additional tax, or the tax for additional properties, it at least speculated and talked about behavioural factors. We think these are important for all aspects of LBTT transactions, and particularly so with the five-year forecast time horizon. And so it is of increasing urgency in our minds that modelling for LBTT really move on and really begin to incorporate appropriate behavioral factors. In terms of landfill, there was discussion in the earlier session about policy, today's policy, tomorrow's policy. We're all keeping an eye on whether the Scottish Government's policy is in fact having the effect that it is expected to have. So that's an area of real focus for NDRI, and this is Andrew's key area of focus, and you'll see in the report, we have to bottom out the nature of the impact of buoyancy through the cycle, and particularly, you know, what happens, you know, cyclically in terms of buoyancy. Once we really have our arms around that, then we can begin to pull in and look at wider and broader economic factors. And finally, on the additional properties tax, there's no real data. We have very, very little to go on for this particular segment in Scotland. We don't know a lot about who and how many, and there's speculation about what the pool of properties might be. But clearly there has to be some further work on that area as well. Finally, it is about outturns, which I've just mentioned. We need to see what really happened in relation to previous forecasts. So those are our areas of concern. We've expressed those in the report. We've also expressed them verbally to the Scottish Government. We expect the Scottish Government to come back to us as promised with their views and our recommendations, what their plans are and how they intend to react to these. And we have stated in various fora, and will state again, that we believe that they will likely need to enhance their forecasting resources in order, for instance, to develop the LBTT model further. So that's really what we expect from the Scottish Government. That leaves me to close simply by asking the Finance Committee for any feedback you might have on the report, in addition to your questions.
Thank you very much for that, Lady Rice. Professor Leith, have you got anything you wish to add at this point?
No, nothing at this point.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, I think it's an excellent, very comprehensive report, and it certainly does fulfil transparency criteria in that you've given great detail of all the meetings you've had, for example, with Scottish Government officials and what's been discussed at these meetings. But let's go into the report itself. Obviously, what I'll do is I'll open with some questions, and then colleagues will come in subsequently. I'm intrigued by paragraph 1.21, where you say, in the analysis of residential LBTT, the Commission proposed that the forecasters might benefit from a review of the work of Best and Cleven, 2015, which examined the impact of property taxes on the timing, volume and price of housing transactions. And then you say, in each case, the forecasters choose themselves whether or not to pursue these alternative approaches. I'm just wondering, you've mentioned you know, that further on your report. I'm just wondering, if you want to tell us a wee bit about that, because you've given us a wee bit of a teaser there.
Two aspects to that. What is the importance of the Best and Cleven work? And Campbell obviously is best equipped to speak to that. But the other is to make the point, and it's really the last sentence in that paragraph, that in our conversations and our challenge meetings with the Scottish Government, we might propose that they would look at a particular instrument in a certain way or bring in work that has been done externally. But at the end of the day, we are not agreeing with them, and they don't agree with us that they will do that. All we do is challenge them to do these things. They then make a choice about whether or not they will do. And I think they address some of those choices in the appendix to their forecasting methodology papers. So that's why that last sentence appears there. But in terms of the actual value of Best and Cleven, over to you, Campbell.
Okay. The Best and Cleven papers, it's an academic paper looking at the impact of changing property transactions taxes on the property market. And it is one of a relatively small number of papers that look at this issue. So when the Scottish Government were looking at the potential impacts of forestalling, we recommended that they look at this paper in depth and maybe try to replicate what the paper did using Scottish data to try and assess the magnitude of forestalling and behavioural effects. So it's an example of we've kind of dipped into the academic literature, provided the Scottish Government with these resources and suggested it might be something worth looking at in order to enhance their forecasting efforts.
Okay, thank you for that. I mean, in paragraph 3.5, you said that what drove the Commission's initial concerns is that the current forecasting methods essentially amount to an extrapolation of historical data for housing prices and transactions towards a long-run average. In the following paragraph, you then say some kind of ongoing assessment of the sustainability of developments in the housing market would be a useful way of monitoring possible corrections to the market and the impact that would have on forecast revenues. And then thirdly, as you emphasised quite a lot of thought in your opening statement, Leith Rice, you say that the current approach contains no behavioural responses to changes in tax regime. And of course, again, that's repeated further in your report. So I'm just wondering if you can extrapolate a wee bit more on these comments.
Okay, so the current approach to forecasting residential LBTT revenues is essentially it's built up of a forecast for house prices and a forecast for transactions, which are then applied to a probability distribution, which gives the probability that you'll observe a transaction at a particular house value. So the driving factors are prices and aggregate transactions. Prices are forecast using what's called an AREMA model, which is essentially just a statistical approach which says, well, house prices next year will be some function of house prices in the past. So it's a kind of statistical extrapolation of historical house price growth. The transactions data is not modelled in a statistical way. It's an extrapolation from more recent data towards the kind of long-term average that Robert talked about earlier today. So both of these approaches, given the estimates of the AREMA model and given just the fundamental approach of extrapolating transactions, both of these approaches essentially take historical data and move house price growth towards its long-run average and transactions towards their long-run average as well. So if you were in a period where the economy was going into a boom and house prices were moving away from the long-term average or transactions were moving away from the long-term average, this approach wouldn't capture that. So it wouldn't get a boom in the housing market, it wouldn't get a bust in the housing market. The statistical evidence from the literature also suggests that it wouldn't capture the transition from a boom to a bust. So if there was a bubble in the housing market, which was then going to burst, this kind of approach wouldn't really capture those kind of turning points. And what the literature suggests is that you need a more multivariate approach, which uses a range of variables, possibly with more theoretical grounding and inherent modelling. It's incredibly difficult to do, but there are approaches out there. They work in some instances. We would encourage the Scottish Government to pursue these. They may work, they may not.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, in terms of non-domestic rates income in paragraph 5.4, you said in the forecasting and buoyancy for the 2015-16 draft budget, Scottish Government forecasters used a range of macroeconomic data to justify raising the buoyancy forecast above its historical average. The Commission discouraged this approach as no link between the macroeconomic variables and buoyancy had been formally demonstrated to justify the magnitude of the government. And then you talk a wee bit further about buoyancy, obviously. So I'm just wondering if you can give us a wee bit more about your thinking in terms of the issue of buoyancy and how the Scottish Government can improve, shall we say, its forecasting in that area.
Okay. So last year, the way the Scottish Government approached the whole issue of forecasting buoyancy was to essentially start from the long-run average. And then it looked at a range of economic indicators. Was GDP growth higher? Was unemployment going down? Was business confidence going up? A whole range of factors that it had. And if it believed that the economy was strengthening, would then shift the buoyancy forecast above its average. If it believed the economy was not strengthening, would then shift the average down. The problem we had with that was that there was no formal assessment of, suppose GDP growth has increased by 0.5%. How does that 0.5% translate into the deviation of buoyancy from its long-run average? Should buoyancy go up by 0.5% as well, or by 1%, by less than? There was no formal link between the two. So I think our position was, until that formal link was demonstrated, it was advisable not to make. It was essentially an ad hoc adjustment.
That's very clear.
What we then subsequently recommended was that there was a very limited span of data for buoyancy, so it was very difficult to do any kind of modelling work on buoyancy at all. So we recommended that they try to obtain a longer historical series for buoyancy. So they managed to obtain such a series, and they managed to create a kind of second proxy series from non-domestic rates, income, receipts as well. So we now have two historical data series for buoyancy. And what you note is if you look at these two series historically, there seems to be a cyclical pattern in them. So every time there's a revaluation cycle, there's a kind of peak in buoyancy, which then slowly declines. And then there's another revaluation year, that jumps back up again and slowly declines. And given the way the buoyancy numbers are constructed, revaluation cycles should have no impact on buoyancy. So it was a bit of a puzzle why this pattern was there. So throughout the year, we've kind of pushed Scottish Government and they've explored with the Association of Assessors why this pattern may exist, given a priori, we're not quite sure why it should exist. And they've come up with this story about the relationship between the revaluation cycle and what are called rolling revaluations. And the idea is that you can appeal kind of revaluation, well, you can appeal the rateable value of properties at any point in time if the nature of that property changes, but you can only appeal revaluations in the year that the revaluation occurs. And what tends to happen is that these kind of rolling revaluations are only resolved once the revaluation appeals are resolved. So this gives a mechanism for explaining this cyclical pattern, which we've encouraged the Scottish Government to quantify whether this can reasonably explain the pattern. We now believe that it can. We're looking for further work on this to strengthen our description of this cyclical pattern, because it's really only by controlling for this that you can then extract the residual information from the series to assess to what extent buoyancy is affected by other economic variables such as GDP growth, unemployment, and all the rest. So we're halfway through a process of enhancing the data, the description of the data, to allow a more formal modelling of buoyancy in the future.
Okay, thank you very much for that comprehensive answer. Now, moving on to land and buildings transaction tax, new for 2016-17. Paragraph 7.1, you say the proposed 3% slab tax is envisaged to be applied to additional residential property transactions in excess of £40,000, with revenues generated between £45 and £75 million. However, what you've said basically is that the transaction tax will effectively wipe out return in the first year of buy-to-let investment, for the reasons you explain. And then you say that this will affect the price distribution of the first homes. At present, this is not in the forecasting model. And so you're suggesting, therefore, ultimately in 7.9, that a final revenue estimate for 2016-17 is between 17 and 29 million, which, of course, is significantly different from what the Scottish Government is actually predicting. So I'm just wondering, again, if you can talk us through your thinking in that a wee bit more, obviously, because that's quite a significant difference.
Okay, I think these are the Scottish Government's figures. It's just talking through the various adjustments they've made to the underlying forecast. So there's a base forecast. If you just say, well, let's try to identify the transactions that would fall under this tax if everything proceeded as it currently does. So there's various bits of information about the extent of buy-to-let mortgages, the number of purchases of such properties through the year, and so on. And these give rise to the kind of first paragraph headline figure. There's then various adjustments that the Scottish Government have made to try and reflect behavioural factors. So this is one case where the Scottish Government is actually trying to take account of these behavioural impacts. And there's a whole series of adjustments that ultimately downgrade the forecast once these behavioural responses are taken account of. That's essentially what this note details.
OK, that's fine. That's great. And in terms of improving the forecasting process, what you've said is that in 8.2 is that data limitations may place a constraint on the forecaster's ability to apply more sophisticated methods, and we're increasingly concerned about the residential LBTT forecasts, which still assume no behavioural responses. So you've got two issues here. One, has the data been availability been improving? That's an issue that's concerned the committee for a number of years. So, again, When we were talking about non-domestic rates income, you talked about the limited span of data with regard to buoyancy. So if there's issues in terms of data, which there clearly are in your view, what areas should the Scottish Government try to focus on improving the data availability where possible?
Okay, so, well, there have been a number of improvements in terms of data availability through the year. So for the buoyancy figures, we now have, it's not a tremendously long, but a longer historical time series, and there's two versions of that time series as well. So that's a clear improvement. We're starting also to get outcome data from the taxis themselves, which clearly helps us assess the validity of the forecasts and so on. There's also a new series from HMRC on transactions, property transactions for Scotland, which didn't exist before for the non-residential sector, which has also allowed us to undertake further evaluation of the validity of the underlying forecast. So data is coming on stream. We're also encouraging, in some of our recommendations, the Scottish Government to look at data that should exist on more micro data on transactions, to look at both individual transactions, so you can get the kind of distribution of transactions across the price range of properties, for example. So we believe that there is cases where there's data there, and we would ask Scottish Government forecasters to utilise that data. But as always, there's never enough data. Any piece of data, historical data, as long a run as you can get, the better.
And more emphasis on behavioural responses.
Yes, that's the...
Yes. If I could just add a footnote to what Campbell said, there may be instances where it may not be possible to get data. For instance, if you look at the high end of property transactions, the numbers are low enough in Scotland that releasing data, HMRC released data, for instance, it might be possible to identify taxpayer and property and so forth. So, you know, at some point, when you look at microdata, there may be some restrictions and limitations on this.
Okay, thank you for that. Okay, I'm going to open up the session now, and the first colleague to ask a question will be John, followed by Mark.
Thanks, convener. Thanks very much for your report, which I think makes good reading. Just a few things that I picked out on the way through. You mentioned Lady Rice too in your introduction about having a protocol. It's referred to, I think, on page 5, 1.24, scrutinising the forecast and receipts, and that will develop into a protocol. Can you just maybe explain what that would mean?
Yes, it was searching for the right word, so it may not be a technical word, but it is to respond to some of the conversation we've had with the Finance Committee in the past, because you've wanted yourselves, but anyone, to feel that they really understood how we operated, how we worked. And the protocol is really to, building on this most recent year's experience, which was a much fuller and richer experience for us, the protocol would be a description of how we interact with the Scottish Government, what we do, you know, what our program of work is during the year, just how we go about doing these things. So that's, as I say, really in response to some of what you've helped us focus on from past conversations.
Okay, that's helpful. So there'll probably be an agreement between the two, between yourselves and the government, but this is more from your angle, how you view it all. And
this is how we intend to go about doing our work. Yeah.
That's great. Thanks very much.
Yeah.
Just add to that, the way we develop the protocol will also be, well, obviously be contingent on the remit that we ultimately get,
yes,
from the bill and the response to your report as the bill goes through Parliament. So,
yes, I'll come back onto that afterwards. I was going to come onto that, what your remit might be, yes. Some of the other specifics are on page 8. It talks about 3.5, this is, concerns about the current forecasting methods being an extrapolation of historical data, and then the point that if the housing market was drifting away from its long-term average, would that be picked up? And I was quite interested in that. I think Mr. Chote kind of mentioned that in his evidence, which I think you were in for, about this whole thing about you know, are we on a long-term trend? Are we returning to a long-term trend? Or is there a new trend just starting? And how do we know the difference between all of that? So is that, can you just explain what your concerns are around that?
Yes, I mean, that's the, well, the kind of nuts and bolts of forecasting are trying to be able to discern what's going on. Is this a long-term trend? Is it a cyclical component? Is it just random variation? And there's a whole host of techniques you can use to try and identify what's going on in terms of specific variables. So the approach currently being adopted by the Scottish Government in terms of the housing market is a kind of straightforward extrapolation technique, which works well in normal times, but wouldn't capture these kind of instances where a new trend was developing and we were moving away from what we had previously.
A new trend starting, surely it's impossible to predict.
Well, there are techniques for identifying time variation and trends, so you can see that your trend that you had historically is no longer applying to the current releases of data.
So it'd be a question of picking up a new trend once it started.
Well, it depends. So in simple statistical models, you can use techniques which would allow you to pick up new trends as they develop. So the idea is that you pick up turning points very quickly. There's more structural modelling, which tries to say, well, fundamentally, house prices should be driven by the earnings of the people that are buying the houses, the state of the economy, and so on. It's a far bigger economic modelling exercise. But with that more structural modelling exercise, you may even be able to anticipate that turning point, which that's the kind of holy grail, what we call the holy grail of forecasting, to be able to do that. And there are examples in the literature where people claim that certain techniques can do that at certain points in time. So.
I suppose I remain slightly sceptical whether you'll ever get the holy grail, but anyway. I mean, I think probably linked to that, the convener kind of touched on it, but page 14, 3.23, talks about it remains unclear to what extent this is a temporary phenomenon and the market, certain sections of the market will reduce activity in the longer term. So again, it's this question of what is temporary and what is a kind of more permanent. And I mean, I wondered, there's also been mention of the fact that maybe the private letting sector or buy-to-let is expanding over time. Is that the kind of longer-term change that we're wondering if there's an impact here?
Well, it's various factors. I think if you turn to table one on page 10, that might help frame the answer to this question. So in table one, I think evidence we gave to you earlier, which was trying to assess how well the outturn data mapped to the forecast. So what table one does in the first couple of columns is it allocates the forecast of 235 million for residential LBTT across months, given the seasonal variability you get in house prices and transactions. We then contrast that with the outturn data to get the size of the forecast error. And that's a kind of measure of the kind of forestalling, could be interpreted as a measure of the forestalling that's going on in that market. And what we were interested in seeing is to what extent does that forecast error taper away as we move away from the date the tax was implemented. And we now have an extra month of data since we constructed this table, which for the first time actually has a negative forecast error. So more revenue was generated than was forecast.
So the 3%, the next tax change coming in, haven't we? So well, presumably there's forestalling started already for that?
Well, it should be starting now, yeah. So not for the November numbers, but yeah. But, yep, there'll be those.
So then we start having the two forestalling interacting with each other.
Oh, there's forestalling on top of forestalling, yes.
Yes, uh-huh. Yes.
But the interesting thing from Table 1, or the updated data that goes into Table 1, is that what we were concerned with before was that it looked as though forestalling was tapering away by August, but then it seemed to bounce back again in September. The two subsequent months we now have for October and November seem to suggest that the forecast is back on track at that point. So as a kind of initial look at this, it looks as though the forestalling has maybe bottomed out around 30 million by this point in time.
Right. Okay, that's helpful, thank you. And I mean, also, well, with the point about headline forecasts, page 16, 3.31, talks about the unfortunate inconsistency in the Scottish Government OBR, presence of forestalling effects, whether they're included in the headline or not. Is this important, or is this just a presentational thing?
It's a very minor aside.
Right. Okay, we'll leave it at that one then. Now, except the point, I think the convener said that he understood the whole report, and that was good. But there were some words in it that I was kind of struggling with, and I just wondered if you could explain. The following paragraph, 3.32, it talks about the simple univariate forecasting of house prices. I wasn't quite sure I knew what univariate was.
Well, univariate versus multivariate. So univariate is when you take the historical data for house prices and you use that to extrapolate forwards to predict house prices. So house prices are the only variable being used to forecast house prices. A multivariate approach would use house prices, interest rates, mortgage availability, all kinds of data to forecast house prices. So it's just one variable forecasting one variable in a univariate.
So is it fair to say that univariate's simplistic, or is that unfair?
Well, it's simpler.
Simpler.
Education system.
Another one I'm not sure I understood, page 18, 3.39, we're talking about we regressed the natural logarithm, and I do vaguely remember logarithms at school, but I've been toiling a little bit. Can you just explain what we're trying to do in here? Are we saying that the question is, as the UK market changes, is the Scottish market changing in exactly the same way or in a slightly different way?
Yeah, what the Scottish Government were using for the forecast is the kind of the OBR's forecasts for transactions in the non-residential market. But I think it was October, the HMRC published data on the Scottish equivalent data. So we now have data for non-commercial property transactions for Scotland. So given that we now have those two data series, we can now look to see to what extent do these two data series move together. Is it a good assumption to use the OBR forecasts in the Scottish forecast for non-residential LBTT? So what we do is we take the two data series for the UK data and the Scottish data, and we see, well, suppose the UK data goes up, transactions go up by 1%, what percentage increase in transactions in Scotland should we expect? And we should roughly expect there to be a 1% increase in Scotland too. Therefore, using the UK data for Scotland in this instance doesn't seem like a bad thing to do.
Now, I mean, you end up in the next paragraph, it ends up saying that 89 or 87% of the variation in Scottish transactions can be explained by the UK transactions. And then it says, since neither estimate is statistically significantly different from unity, so 87, 89% isn't significant.
Okay, the different from unity is the elasticity. So we measure how much Scottish transactions change when UK transactions change by 1%. And that estimate is 0.94 in one case and 1.08 in the other, which is not statistically significantly different from one. So basically, when UK transactions go up by 1%, Scottish transactions would be expected to go up by 1% as well.
Right. OK, that's helpful. Thank you. And going on to page 36, which also mentions elasticity, 7.10, Your emphasis in there, I think, is there's a huge amount of uncertainty around, this is a 3% LBTT, I think, the new transaction tax, because the closest example we've got is the stamp duty holiday of 2008. So you kind of seem to me to really emphasise the uncertainty of all this, and then you say, bearing these caveats in mind, we are prepared to endorse these forecasts as reasonable. Can you just... That seems a little bit strange to me that we're saying it's very uncertain, or are we just saying it's so impossible to know that anything's reasonable?
It's a bit like, I think we've discussed in the past, the Bank of England's inflation forecast has this kind of fan chart, which they've got their central estimates, and then they've got the range of uncertainty that widens as you push that forward in time. We're essentially saying that this central estimate is a reasonable one, but that the uncertainty around about it is really very large.
Okay, and my final point then, moving on to is 8.2 on the following page, page 37. Talk about the forecasting methodologies and about the challenge meetings you've had. And I mean, it strikes me I'm very impressed with this report. There's bits in it which, you know, are at the edges of my understanding as far as some of the terminology is concerned. But, you know, I'm glad that somebody other than the Finance Committee is out there challenging the forecasts, because I don't think the Finance Committee could have done this kind of work. And that makes me think that if you, as the Commission, were producing the forecasts, is there somebody out there that could challenge you and have all these challenge meetings? And how would we handle that?
And I think that that is an absolutely pertinent question if that were to come out of the bill in due course. Right now, and we've said this, I think, before, we have a system where the official forecasts are produced by the government and the Commission assesses those. If we were to produce the official forecast, my capital F from our last meeting, we would absolutely, and you would certainly want our forecasts to be challenged and scrutinized by another body. So in order for us to do that, I think that Parliament might have to think about who would that other body be? Would a new body have to be created to do that? Yeah, I mean, I would have thought cause great concern if the Commission simply produced the official forecasts and that was it.
Yeah, okay, that's my point. Thanks so much.
Mark before we gather.
Convener, it's been quite comprehensive there from the Deputy Convener, so I've got a couple of additional questions. It touches on, I think, Professor Leith, your remarks around the holy grail of forecasting, if you will, the ability to predict boom and bust. I guess the question would be, you know, if this were possible, wouldn't somebody be doing it in terms of being able to predict these things? And secondly, how much of it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, particularly in terms of predicting a bubble burst? If you say in year X, we think the housing market bubble is going to burst, does it become a self-fulfilling prophecy because you essentially predict that it will happen and therefore the markets react accordingly?
Okay, well, I think there's quite a large literature on all aspects of forecasting, and this is just one of them. There are examples in that literature of people constructing models which, out of sample, are able to forecast key events. But there's also lots of evidence of models that looked good in the past, but then when there is a big change, they miss it completely. So it's an imperfect science. There is lots of approaches. I think my own personal view is that what it's best to do is to have a range of approaches employed so that if one of them is ringing alarm bells about a possible bubble in the housing market, then you look into that more deeply. If the other approaches are not, then you try to reconcile them. So it's a whole range of, like the Bank of England employs a whole suite of models to forecast the economy, not just one model. So I think I would recommend that you use all the analytical tools you have available to come at it from every angle.
And I guess the question would be, how much does that add to both the time element in terms of the time required in order to undertake the forecasting and the challenge element of that? But also, is there an additional cost in terms of human resource that would be required in order to undertake that more complicated forecasting methodology that you've described?
Yeah, I think the last time we discussed this in some detail, what you would probably do is undertake the kind of simpler forecasting methods on a kind of day-to-day, year-to-year basis as your fundamental driver of the forecast. But then you would want to do maybe deeper, more sophisticated, one-off pieces of analysis which help to identify these kind of turning points or whether there's significant behavioural factors that you need to take account of or maybe don't need to take account of. So it's a kind of complementary approach where you do kind of more what I would describe as more fundamental, deeper economic analysis to assess whether or not there are issues that you really need to take account of when applying your simpler day-to-day forecasting techniques. that analysis may indicate that you don't need to worry about that issue, or it may flag something up as being important.
And setting aside the convener's caveat regarding the Commission's role and what the remit of the Commission will be once the bill has gone through, but on the basis of what is proposed in the bill at present, is that a function that the Commission itself would perhaps carry out in terms of its challenge, or would that be something that the Commission would expect the government itself to carry out following challenge, or to then be challenged and probed by the Commission? How would you see that evolving?
Well, I think at the moment we're kind of we've got the possibility of producing our own technical working papers, and we have a number of projects underway which are looking at various issues, which would be our own pieces of research. Depending on what these pieces of research then deliver, we would then take these to the Scottish Government and say, in light of this research, it suggests that this is an important issue that your forecast, which you own, should ideally take account of. It's then up to the Scottish Government whether or not they incorporate those extra pieces of analysis that we've performed independently.
Moving on to the devolved taxes, specifically the LBTT and the discussion that's been had around forestalling. Deputy Convener, I think, very helpfully highlighted the slab tax for buy-to-let properties or second properties, which are generally buy-to-let but not always, that will apply in the coming financial year, and the potential, therefore, for a forestalling effect in relation to those properties to begin to emerge. I guess the two questions I would have is, you've mentioned that the forestalling would require a longer-term analysis of LBTT transactions to understand how much of the figures were affected by forestalling and how much were affected by a deeper market changes or other external factors. So the first question is, how long a period would be required for that? And then the second question would be, at what point would you be able to make a reasonable assumption of a forestalling impact in relation to the newly introduced slab tax in terms of this current financial year? At what point would we be able to look and say that's because of that and not because of something else?
In the kind of table one that I referred to earlier, that's essentially an attempt, a first pass attempt to try and see whether forestalling has come to an end or not. And what we see by looking through the forecast errors is that they were large immediately after the introduction of the tax, but they've now essentially tapered away. So that, as a first pass, gives us some confidence that by November, the forestalling effects have come to a close. However, we want to look at that more deeply. We'll try to look at the micro data. We want to look at the distribution of individual transactions to assess whether or not, maybe at the top end of the market, there's still an ongoing effect, which is just being compensated for some other effect, some other part of the distribution, which is driving these figures. So we have some initial evidence. We'll look at the issue more deeply. It could well be that by this point we should be able to pull together the data necessary to reach that conclusion.
Does the fact that there are not figures prior to this financial year in terms of Scottish stamp duty, does that hamper some of that effort?
It hampers our ability to look at the mirror image of the forestalling, which is the transactions that were brought forward. I think we present some evidence, anecdotal to some extent, on what happened before, based on the evidence that was provided to yourselves at the previous session we had. However, it's not that comparable with the quality of data we have post the introduction of the tax.
And then the following question was around the potential impact of forestalling for next financial year of those properties which would be subject to the slab tax after the commencement of the next financial year, because obviously those won't necessarily be easily identifiable because they won't be paying that slab tax, so you couldn't disaggregate them on that basis. So if we were to see a spike for whatever in one or more of those months, how easily would it be to point at that and say that is a result of forestalling rather than a result of some other market impact?
It would be extremely difficult to disentangle. So it's, I think effectively you're probably going to have to look until after the tax has been introduced and then see how the revenue figures for that evolve over time.
And that would probably be more than one fiscal year. You'd have to see what patterns came in the future in order to do that. I mean, at the end of the day, forestalling, embedded in forestalling is a conundrum because you don't ever really know who has changed their mind, who hasn't gone in for a transaction because of the change in tax rate. You just don't know.
Yes, the question is about the variability, but then you said we need to look at over more than one fiscal year, and I think that's what I was driving at, was at what point could you legitimately say we have enough data now to be able to assess what the impact of LBTT rates has been versus taking into account forestalling effects, etc., versus any other impacts that might be in play?
So what you can do is you can take the forecast for what the new measure will deliver, kind of pre-forestalling and post-forestalling, and see whether or not the outturn data matches the post-forestalling figures or not. But it's all your assessment is contingent on the forecast itself, the underlying forecast being right, as well as the estimate of the forestalling being right. So it's very difficult to disentangle.
Okay, thanks.
Followed by Jean.
Good morning. The right at the end of the formal part of the report, you conclude, on the whole, the Commission found these forecasts within the constraints of the available data to be reasonable. Just for clarity, are you saying the forecasts are reasonable for financial year 16-17, or are you saying the forecasts are reasonable for the whole of the forecast period?
Saying they're reasonable for the whole of the forecast period, but we would emphasise that the error bands around them are widening as you go forward in time. So,
okay. But it's in terms of the word reasonable, it's for the whole period. It's
yes.
Not. It's not just for 16-17.
No, right. It is okay. The forecast which embodies the 5 years.
Sure. Okay. Thank you. Fine. I just wanted to be clear on that. If we move on to LBTT first. I don't have any questions on non-residential, and I actually concur with the convener. I quite like what you've done there with the reverse logarithm and so on, and it leads me to no questions on that area. I do have questions on residential, though, as you might expect. The Scottish Government forecast for the next financial year for residential, ignoring the transaction supplement, so they've ignored the additional tax. On the purely residential transactions outside of that, their forecast for the next financial year is £295 million, which you obviously think is reasonable. I'm just trying to get a sense of what sort of a figure, in your opinion, would be unreasonable, both at the upper end or the lower end, just to get some sense of you may not have an exact number, but just to get a sense, what at an upper end and a lower end, where are we beginning to get into unreasonable territory?
Okay, I think my assessment. Will I go first?
Yeah, you go.
No,
but that's fine. You're maybe going to say the same thing.
Yeah. So I think for me, a large part of what I would then define as reasonable is contingent on the method that's been used to generate the forecast. So you know, I've gone into the spreadsheet which details all the underpinning assumptions, all the technical modelling aspects that underpin this forecast. And I go through all of those assumptions, the way the modelling works. I'm looking for things where that's obviously inconsistent with data. That's a bad assumption to make. I just don't believe that assumption. These are all the things that would lead me to believe that forecast as a result was not reasonable. And that's the whole scrutiny meetings are going through this method, lots of detail, giving very tough challenges. So why are you doing it that way? Does the data not suggest you should be doing it that way? Can you justify why it's done this way? Give us the evidence that explains why it's done that way. And that's what underpins reasonableness.
And I think that's a really important question, because if anyone assumed that what we were doing was looking at the output numbers and saying that's a right number, that's a wrong number, that's better, that's worse. We're not looking at the outputs, we're looking at the inputs. It's a really important distinction to make. That's what we're making our judgments on. What is the basis, what are the factors, and therefore what are the numbers and the time series, whatever they are, that are going into each of these forecasting models. But we're not then saying, oh, we think that number is the right number. We're not making that judgment.
Sure. Okay, I mean, you're not coming down on the right number, but if you go back to the fan chart points that you talked about, the Bank of England, I mean, I'm pleased to hear you're playing about with the model, you're looking at all the assumptions. That's what I would hope for and expect. But in doing all of that, can you not then get a sense of what an unreasonable number would be, both at a higher or lower end, or is that simply impossible?
Methodologies were if the forecasters failed to include some important factors as they ran their model, we would likely say, well, this is unreasonable because you're not giving us enough evidence to say that is legitimate. So the number is just the output of the sausage machine, if you will. We're looking at what goes in.
Yeah. Maybe I give another example. It's going back to the report from last year. So I think last year when buoyancy was being forecast, as I think we've already discussed, it took the long-run average and then it adjusted that depending on the forecaster's view of the general state of the economy, but not in a way which formally linked that measure of the state of the economy to the adjustment to buoyancy. And the adjustment that was made pushed the increase in buoyancy to the kind of level at which it would be one of the largest increases in buoyancy we would have seen in the limited span of data we had. So I think we described this as being optimistic, very optimistic, and that was on the cusp of just about becoming unreasonable if it had been pushed any further than that, I think. But so in that sense, we would reach a limit, which point we would say, no, that's just unacceptable.
Okay, thank you. Sticking with residential LBT, so I've read through all the comments you made about LBTT on a residential sense, and you make a number of areas for development and a number of concerns. When I take them all together, firstly, you think there should be a multivariate approach. Then you think there should be an examination of the distributional changes. You then, to use your words, increasingly concerned that there is no behavioural analysis whatsoever on the primary part of LBTT, and you then raise some questions about £188 million of £545 million coming purely from fiscal drag. So four concerns. Two of them, I have to say, to me seem quite major, but despite all of those concerns, how can you then sign off the residential LBTT as reasonable, given that you've used the term increasingly concerned?
Yes, I think our concern is that economically, in terms of economic theory, you would expect there to be a behavioural response to relatively high tax rates, and given the fiscal drag effects that we document, that more and more transactions are being pushed into that part of the distribution. The issue is we don't quite know how big these effects are. Are they significant? Are they small? Are they something we really need to worry about, or is it just something? Are we worrying about nothing? So there's not enough evidence to tip us against saying the forecasts are unreasonable at the moment. We do, however, wish to look at this and gather the evidence that would then say, well, no, these forecasts really need to take account of this, or, well, no, actually, it's not such a big deal as we thought.
Okay. I suppose the reason I asked, does it push you towards unreasonable is this. When I read the Scottish Government's devolved taxes forecasting methodology paper, when they look at the supplementary charge on LBTT, so the bit that was announced at the budget, they have looked at behavioural impact there. They accept entirely that there will be a behavioural impact. Their projection for that part of the tax is that they will collect £23 million next year. But they reckon that £23 million has been affected by between £8 and £13 million due to behavioural impact. So on a £23 million tax collection, that's changed by between £8 and £13 million because of a behavioural impact. So that's quite a huge slice of it. So I suppose my concern is this: if that's how much that £23 million is effective, what sort of effect could there be on a £295 million? And if it's of a similar magnitude, and that's just a big if, but if it was of a similar magnitude, you know, in my personal view, those assumptions or those forecasts would be unreasonable if you're just assuming no behavioural impact. So in your view, what needs to happen on behavioural impact? You know, you mentioned it to the government last year. You've mentioned it at every meeting you've been at them, from what I can see. You're now using phrases like increasingly concerned, but they still just say we're assuming there's no behavioural impact. And at what point does that become unreasonable?
Yeah, well, I think in relation to the kind of the additional measure, first of all, it's a very specific segment of the market where you would probably expect behavioural effects to be far stronger than for the market as a whole. So they are slightly separate bits of the market. I think what we're hoping is that the Scottish Government will give us a response in the near future to our recommendations, indicating what it is how they plan to respond to those.
Okay. Move on to non-domestic rates. Then I appreciate that, I think you said Professor Hughes Hallett, that's his specialism, so there may be other comments he wishes to make in due course. But from what I can see, we're only getting a one-year forecast for non-domestic rates. Is that correct, or have I missed something?
No, there's a five-year buoyancy forecast is what we evaluated, which takes account of the cyclical pattern that I discussed earlier. So what we looked at was the full five-year
buoyancy. But in terms of the actual numbers, I'm just as a question of clarification, I can only see a one year's worth of numbers in the budget. Have you seen 5 years' worth of actual numbers?
I think our remit...
No.
Tells us to focus on buoyancy, so buoyancy is the thing that we've been evaluating. I'm not sure if we saw the revenue implications of those buoyancy forecasts or not. I can't remember, to be honest.
Okay. No, I mean, I appreciate your remit is different. But I was just wondering if I'd literally missed it somewhere, but maybe not then in that case. I suppose, so your remit is looking at buoyancy, and so it's harder for you to comment on the numbers, but just in terms of patterns, if one looks at the budget itself, the projection or the forecast for non-domestic rates is lower for the next financial year, 16-17, by about £30 million than it was for 15-16. So given that the economy is growing, given that there are projected increases for the other taxes that you've looked at, while you obviously don't look at the exact numbers, does it not strike you as unusual that non-domestic rates in cash terms is projected to be lower in the next financial year? And I wonder if that was discussed with government.
Yeah, well, I think the reason for this is this cyclical pattern that I discussed earlier. So in previous years, there was no adjustment made for this cyclical pattern. The data span wasn't long enough to allow us to identify that pattern. But now that we've found it to exist, the Scottish Government have adjusted their buoyancy forecasts and therefore the non-domestic rates income to account for this. So given the position we are in the revaluation cycle, that would reduce the revenues you would get at that point in the cycle.
Okay, so that, I mean, to me that might have reduced it against the initial forecast, but given the rate of economic growth, are you saying that buoyancy change could effectively be bigger than the economic growth, and therefore in cash terms you collect less?
Well, the buoyancy forecast doesn't take account of economic growth, so that was another issue we've discussed. Mm. That previously they were adjusting it, but in an ad hoc fashion, given kind of a broad brush evidence on the state of the economy. What we're asking them to do in our report, Scottish Government forecasters to do in our report, is once we've completely controlled for this cyclical pattern, we then want to squeeze whatever remaining information is in that data series and relate that to the economic determinants of buoyancy to take account of these kind of factors.
Okay. And last question then. The if I wrote it down correctly, when the Cabinet Secretary gave his statement to Parliament on the budget, he said he was increasing the large business supplement of non-domestic rates, and he thought that would bring in an additional £130 million. Were you asked to look at that at all, or was that outside of your
outside of our remit. Yeah.
Okay. All right, thank you. All right, that's all good.
Into four by Jackie.
Thank you. Just three short points, really. In paragraph 121 on page 4, that you discuss the challenging meetings that you have. And I just wonder, is that, going back to the kind of relationship that you have with the Scottish Government and your independence, is that something that in time, I mean, am I right in assuming that at the moment that's you who are doing that? But in time with staff and so on, is that something that would change?
Well, at the moment, it's the Fiscal Commission is present, and we have two part-time research assistants as well who attend the meetings as well, largely in an observational capacity.
And to take away some work assignments following the meetings.
Yeah, just so they know the discussions that went on, and that can inform the work they are doing for us.
Yeah. And when we've taken evidence from the Cabinet Secretary, he has always, two meetings at least, been absolutely adamant that whatever changes you propose to the budget or to the outcomes that are being forecast, that he will accept that. Is that what you understand it to be? So whatever you're reading and seem to be reasonable in the figures that you produce, any changes that are made, that these changes would be made and presented by the Scottish Government?
I think our understanding is, I believe what he said, looking at some of your transcripts, is that he would want to go to Parliament with a draft budget only when the budget was seen to be reasonable, because, you know, now I interpret, why would you bring a budget that was not seen to be reasonable to Parliament to discuss? It doesn't make any sense. And that's how I understood his thinking. I may or may not be correct on that. What we are not doing is advising or guiding. We're not doing that kind of work. So all we can do is go in and say, give us the evidence for, you know, why you've included these numbers and why you've approached this particular instrument this way and why you haven't looked at such and such, or can you take a look at such and such and come back and tell us whether that makes any difference. And at some point we think, well, they've provided adequate evidence and they've sort of followed their model and so forth. That gives us that judgment of reasonable or not. If, for instance, we were talking about this yesterday, a forecast model might be, or the forecast might be judged as being reasonable, and then perhaps the next year they would stay with the same model, but a major policy change might actually knock it out of that reasonable space. So we would have to speak to that and again, challenge them. That's what we do. We don't say at the end of the day, these are the right numbers. Again, it's this difference between the input numbers and the output numbers.
I should maybe also emphasise that in this series of challenge or scrutiny meetings we have with the Scottish Government forecasters, at no point do we say, that's it, you've done enough by this point to get a gold star and everything's going to be judged as reasonable. We're critical all the way through. We wait for the final forecast to come out and then we write our report.
Could I say something just to reemphasize? I think I said this earlier today, which is that we don't come to a point of agreement with the forecasters. You know, we don't say, fine, we'll sign off on this. We continue simply to challenge. At the end of the day, they then create the forecast, if that's helpful.
That's helpful. And Lady Rice, you mentioned earlier in this response that you didn't come with new ideas or anything. You were simply reacting to the information that you're given at the Challenger meetings. But in answer to Mark MacDonald earlier, I think Professor Leith said that there are a number of issues that you were thinking about, or working on. And whether the government would accept these other issues. I mean, my next question is kind of related to this, because it seems to me that one of the biggest the biggest change that's coming down the line is the outcome of the Smith Commission and eventually Europe. So how are these issues dealt with in your thinking in terms of government thinking?
two parts perhaps to that question. I don't recollect saying we brought nothing new to the table. I mean, the Best in Cleveland paper, which is already just discussed as an example, that was something new that was brought, and a lot of the challenge, that's all new to the conversation. So I'm not sure what I was, you know, saying at that point. Yes, of course we do, but that's the nature of challenge. We're looking for areas that may not have been addressed or thought about. Or sometimes the challenge is explain to us what your thinking is and what goes into it. So that's one aspect. We've been, in terms of the second part of your question, and I'll give Campbell time to think of more response as well, but we've been quite careful to consider and look closely at what might be the future. But we have a present right now. We have a remit right now. And what we need to do is meet the exigencies of that remit at this stage. And we can't start developing a report that then starts speculating about what the legislation will mean or what the outcome of the Smith proposals will give to us. We know that there will be changes, and we are starting to plan for those and think about them, but that's really separate from the job we have to do today. We felt it was important to focus on what you are expecting from us and to do that as well as we can do and not conflate those. So but your question is correct if the implication is there's a lot of change to come and we need to be on top of that.
Yeah. And is that something that you would do, that you can do independently, or would you be asked, for example, I suspect lots of people are going to want to know what the financial economic implications are for Scotland in or out of Europe. In the arguments that are being made. Is that something the Scottish Government would actually charge you to do, or?
I doubt it, but.
Well, I think, yeah, assessing the cost and benefits of leaving Europe would be outside of our remit at present. But speaking personally, I've given the position I now have in the Fiscal Commission, I've got quite a wide research agenda myself, so I'm undertaking a number of projects which directly relate to what we anticipate coming down the line for the Fiscal Commission. So with colleagues at the University of Durham and a PhD student in Glasgow, we're starting work on building a macroeconometric model for Scotland. We're looking at dynamic Laffer curves, so how variations in tax rates affect revenues. We're looking at these calculations for Scotland as well. With another colleague and another PhD student, we're looking at big data analysis of newspaper articles to build uncertainty indices for Scotland vis-a-vis the rest of the UK and things like that. So there's a whole bunch of projects underway which hopefully will be of use to our future scrutiny work.
And there may be others as well, but because looking to the academic community, I think, is probably a first place you might look for some of those answers. Yeah.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I start where Gavin Brown left off? Because I was curious as to your response about when reasonable becomes unreasonable. And I absolutely accept the distinction that, you know, it's not the figures, it's the method by which this is all assessed. So, I enjoyed reading your report from last year. I enjoyed reading your report from this year. You're consistent in asking for, data on behavioural responses. You're very consistent in asking for that for residential LBTT. In fact, your recommendation, I would say, in this report is framed in slightly stronger language. Now, I don't know whether that I'm implying a frustration that you haven't received it yet or not, but I'm curious as to when you think you've given enough time for the Scottish Government to respond to that. Because as you describe, we all can recognise the behavioural response arising from LBTT and for stalling, and OBR assessed that. We're now going to get an additional behavioural response from the additional LBTT, and it seems as if we've just kind of stuck our finger in the wind to assess that. So I'm curious as to when you will become increasingly impatient.
I think, and I think the forecasters would concur to say that we have been more impatient this year than obviously in the previous year. If you look at their appendix, it's page 21 of the forecasting methodology, and which the government submitted to you, and there they talk about the recommendations we made for the 15-16 draft budget and their response to those. And there hasn't been much response to those, and they know that, and we know that, and we've had discussions about that. And they know that we see this as being the behavioral factors in particular as being quite important, particularly now that we're in a five-year forecast time horizon. And I think that's what creates the urgency, not that we're personally getting impatient with others on a personal level, but that the forecasts are now not 2 years, but 5 years, and we need just better texture to what's coming out. So we would hope to see some changes coming in the next round.
Okay, that was the language that Professor Leith used was hope. Have you got more than hope? Because you're quite right, the action plan doesn't really tell you much about what they're doing to take forward that. In fact, there's no mention of behaviour under LBT TT residential action. So I'm kind of curious as to when you get beyond hope.
Yeah, well, it's kind of up to the Scottish Government to respond. But I think what I would add to what Susan said was as our remit becomes clearer and as our own resources come on stream, we will start to do the analysis ourselves. So if we think it's an important issue, we'll look at it.
And if it turns out to be in our judgment, that is a challenge of a very major sort and becomes more urgent because we've got the evidence.
Yeah. Okay, that's very helpful to know. Can I take you to, I thought the minutes were extremely helpful in describing some of the discussions. What I was less clear about is, for example, in August, you asked for something quite specific on LBTT that was in relation to seasonality. You repeated the request in September, and I didn't know whether there was anything from the November minute that indicated you got it. I'm assuming you did, but I wondered, for the sake of clarity, if somebody reading through not being present at the meetings, whether that could in some way be recorded.
Maybe a list of action points and when they were resolved. Yes, yeah. That would.
Yeah, okay. We can certainly try to do that.
And I take it you got the information.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Can I look at? Sorry. The you included in your report a helpful comparison between OBR and Scottish Government forecasts in relation to LBTT, both for residential and non-residential. And whilst Mr. Chote very diplomatically didn't want to comment on whose forecasting was better, I note that their forecasting for 16-17 is considerably lower than the Scottish Government's. Is there an £42 million is a substantial amount of difference in the residential forecasting. Is there an explanation for that in your view?
Yeah, I think the OBR numbers, I think they incorporated more of the recent outturn data when it came to LBTT for both residential and non-residential than the Scottish Government did. So that's one of the reasons. The Scottish Government also smooths the last few years of non-residential transactions and formulating the base that it projects forwards because of some variability from year to year in the non-residential market. So that would tend to reduce things as well by that smoothing. But as Robert indicated, these are not statistically significant differences given the uncertainties attached to these forecasts. They're much of a muchness.
I know. I just look at 42 million, and if we have to forego that from the budget, it's maybe quite significant in monetary terms,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah, statistically speaking.
Okay. In terms of you said that the OBR included outturn data. Is that not key in measuring what's likely to happen in future?
Well, I think there's different approaches. It's the part year outturn data. For the landfill tax, the Scottish Government forecasters for landfill tax used the two quarters of data we have on landfill data. And that's the base on which the forecast is then pushed forward. For the LBTT data, the forecasts, they used the last complete year of outturn data and not the part year data that we've been discussing in our previous session. One of the recommendations we make is that, particularly in a year like this, where a large part of the year's outturn data has already been revealed, it might be useful to update the forecast in light of that outturn data.
Okay. Could I touch on additional LBTT? Because I wasn't quite sure where Gavin Brown got some of his figures from. Because at the top of page 11, the Scottish Government is forecasting revenue of £45 million to £70 million without accounting for behavioural change and forestalling. So that's or the Scottish Government's starting figure. The fact that it's now down to £17 million to £29 million is of considerable concern because of the drop, and I accept all the analysis they've done to get there. I'm wondering, in the budget, does it include the lower figure or the higher figure as to revenue generated?
The lower figure is the ultimate forecast figure.
So £17 million to £29 million is what we would find in the budget, not 45 to 70. Okay. That's fine. Finally, I think... Oh, no, two more points, convener. I'll be very quick. Non-domestic rates. At paragraph 5.14 in your report, you talk about it's not your job to report on the scale of the forecast errors. How big are the forecast errors? Just out of curiosity.
They're relatively small, because the buoyancy is essentially a forecast of the increase in the stock of rateable value properties. So the revenue itself is generated by the stock, not that increase. So you can make pretty bad forecasts of the increase, but the stock is fairly constant, so the forecast error in terms of revenues is usually relatively small.
Okay, that's helpful to understand what you meant there. Finally, is it not the case, I mean, I hear what you say about revaluation appeals happening at the beginning of a revaluation process, but is it not the case that if you buy a property for the first time, you've got 6 months in which to ask for a revaluation, and therefore throughout the year, not just at key points, you would have revaluations occurring dependent on the number of house sales that there are?
The revaluation data we had access to suggested that these effects were relatively small, but the revaluation cycle itself was a great deal more significant than that.
Okay. And finally, convener, on the Scottish rate of income tax, it was tantalisingly mentioned on page 57, I think that was your minute of the 23rd of September, as a discussion paper 6, and not mentioned at all in your report, other than in the minute. So I'm curious, what do you see the Scottish Fiscal Commission's role to be, given that a lot of the assessment is done by the OBR?
We will have a role, and we've been given some briefing on the nature of the Scottish rate of income tax. We had that early in 2015, and we've joined challenge meetings hosted by the OBR in talking about this. So we've spent some time when we could in this past year becoming more familiar with the actual tax. Our job is to, as you know, current, not future, but current, our job is to scrutinize or assess forecasts made by the Scottish Government. So if the Scottish Government produce something in relation to SRIT, then we will have a role in relation to that forecast.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Richard.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you to members of the Commission for their report. I just want to cover one area, and that is on the capacity for the models which have been developed to take account of variations in regional economies. So I'm going to be quite parochial here, and Lady Rice, you know the Northeast economy well, and that's going through a particularly tough and a very different time from the rest of the Scottish economy at the moment. Particularly, I imagine, would have an impact on issues like LBTT. To what extent, then, and given the fact that this is a very major difference in that economy, which is quite a big economy, it's a big economy within Scotland, has an impact across the country, to what extent are the models able to take account of that kind of scenario at the moment?
Current forecasting models don't have any regional breakdown at all.
So, I mean, so for example, I think the committee last year had evidence that the Aberdeen housing market won't return to its position last year for 5 years. In terms of non-residential property, there's a massive impact, we've heard as well.
If that comes through in the outturn figures for this current year, is that something that which will be able to be factored into models for the future? Because it seems to me that it could have you have to tell me if this is right, but it could have a significant impact in terms of the results going forward.
The current kind of forecasting approach employs this kind of distributional model of housing transactions across the various price bands, but that's for the whole of Scotland. You could construct a similar distribution for a particular region that you thought was going to be behaving differently from the national average and was going through significant changes, and subtract one from the other in producing the forecast. So there are potentially ways of incorporating such regional effects if they were felt to be important.
The current forecasts at the moment don't take account of what's happening in northeast economy. I find it quite surprising in one sense, given that we know it's happening, it's there, there's evidence there about the number of transactions dropping. So, I guess I would feel instinctively quite surprised if therefore there wasn't an effect on the numbers next year.
I'll just say, I appreciate that point and something perhaps we can take away to consider. And the other related point is that the additional properties, particularly buy-to-let market, is particularly big in the Northeast as well. And so we need to think about that new tax possibly from that perspective. So we'll take that away.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Richard. That's concluded questions from the committee members. But some more just want to ask just to finish off the session. In terms of Jackie's question, we talked about outturn data and the fact that in 2015-16 doesn't feed into the forecast for LBTT, but it does for landfill tax. Now, obviously, I think you said that it appears in the report, but I didn't see anything in the report on that. Did I pick you up wrongly there? An explanation as to why that is a situation.
It's a choice on the part of the Scottish Government forecasters, but it's a recommendation we make in the report is that perhaps, particularly in years where a significant span of outturn data does exist for the year, that it is factored into the forecast.
Good. So you clearly believe it should. That's the one thing I was wanting to get clarified. And just in terms of the Annex 1 again, which was touched on, you say recommendation 2, the Scottish Government has investigated developing alternative models for forecasting house prices and transaction volumes. Examination of the requirements to develop new techniques suggests it would take a significant period for Scottish Government economists to produce output to sufficiently robust quality standard. As such, the view was taken that forecasts using these methodologies could not be utilised within this budget cycle with any degree of assurance. There is a potential to develop such methodologies over the long term with a view to utilising these in a future forecasting cycle. I mean, what kind of time period are we actually talking about? And it is obviously of concern that it would take a significant period to produce output to a sufficiently robust quality standard, is it not?
This is the Scottish Government's response. So they are, in response to us pushing on this issue, saying we could look at this, but it would take a while to develop and build the expertise in-house, I think is the word, not there, in order to do this. So they could give you a sense of that time frame. But at the beginning, in my opening remarks, I suggested that in terms of what worries us, the concerns we have, one of them may be that the government needs to enhance its forecasting capability, and that might cover this.
Are you not concerned, though, that that there is no kind of time scale in order to produce such output to a sufficiently robust quality standard, as I've said?
Yes. Well, of course, we've only just seen this report has come out,
right, okay,
with the papers, so we haven't had a further discussion with the forecasters yet about what they mean.
And how soon would you want to be able to see that, and how soon do you think it's practical to be able to achieve that?
Research is always kind of hit or miss whether it works out the way you're hoping it works out.
It looks as how long is a piece of string looks to be the kind of response there.
It shouldn't take years and years, the initial round of modelling that we're looking for.
Okay.
But we'd like work to start on it. I think that's maybe the most important thing, that they actually
They acknowledge that there's an issue. I understand that. But obviously, there's one thing acknowledging it. You want to obviously be able to deal with it. Sorry, Jackie, what's going on?
Tiny supplementary on your point, Convener, because I wasn't quite sure whether I got this right. that you have only just seen that response to your recommendations from last year's report?
We've only seen this report.
The table.
This table, yes. We've had discussions about this issue in meetings and so forth, but we've only seen this report just now.
Yeah. I mean, I just make the observation it might have been much more useful if you'd seen it much earlier and were able to then challenge that response, because it was, of course, for last year.
But we have had those discussions in our challenge meeting, so that has taken place. This is the forecaster's summary of their position here.
Okay. Thank you.
Absolutely ongoing.
Just another couple of points to finish off. Table 5 of the Scottish Government's methodology paper shows non-residential land buildings transaction tax rising by £10 million annually to 2016-17 and 2020-21. Yet there's an increase in the forecast of £74 million over that period. I'm just wondering if you know why that is.
Sorry, which table was?
Table 5.
So why the revenues from one are increasing more dramatically than
the
other?
Well, it's just the figures just don't seem to add up, basically.
This one's increasing £10 million.
Yeah, 16,
17. Okay. The reason why there's the kind of differential trends between the two is that the residential one is based on this probability distribution model, so that as prices rise, you're pushing more and more houses into higher tax bands, and these figures assume that you obtain the revenues from that. The non-residential forecasts going over the five-year period are essentially take the original tax base and raise it by revenue and prices without factoring in any of the fiscal drag that dominates the residential forecast.
I know, it seems a bit odd that there's a £74 million increase in 1 year in the forecast, you know, and yet we're seeing only a £10 million rise increase in the methodology paper. Those two figures just don't seem to me to add up.
So I'm not sure which two figures are you...
The £74 million is from which?
15-16 and 16-17, there's an increase in the forecast of £74 million, but Table 5 of the Scottish Government's methodology paper shows non-residential EBT rising by only 10 million annually.
The jump from last budget's forecast to this year's forecast. Okay, there's various factors.
So it seems
for that.
As if there's been a huge leap, and then
I've misunderstood what you were looking at. So what the Scottish Government did before was they smoothed the tax for non-residential. They smoothed the tax base for 3 years of outturn data before beginning the forecast, but they didn't take account of the fact that you would expect prices to be rising over that period. So it wasn't really aggregating like with like when they were doing that smoothing, and that would impart a kind of downward bias to the forecast. So they've removed that downward bias in this new forecast. Also, prices and transactions are a bit higher than they were anticipating when they did the original forecast. Those two things combined result in the increased forecast.
Okay, that's very clear. Thank you. And just lastly, in your report on the draft budget 2015-16, you recommended in relation to non-residential land buildings transaction tax that new data sources should develop as a high priority. And since then, HMRC has begun to publish data on commercial property transactions in Scotland. Does the existence of this new data mean we can now develop a Scottish model rather than relying on UK-level transactions for the non-residential forecast?
Yeah, there's a reasonable span of data, so you could start to do some fairly straightforward modelling work based on Scottish transactions rather than using UK transactions, yes, which is one of the recommendations
in
our report.
That, yes.
Okay, that's great. Well, thank you very much. Is there any further points you want to make?
No, I think we've covered everything.
Okay, well, thank you. We'll wind up the session there. I'd like to thank you very much for your contributions this morning. We agreed earlier on to move into private session, so I'll just have a one-minute break to allow the members of the public, our witnesses, and the official report to leave.